On the agenda is approve the minutes of the March 23rd, 1999 meeting.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor? All opposed? Minutes are approved. Next item on the agenda under new business is to consider the home daycare application of Rhonda S. Downer for Evergreen Circle. In accordance with the procedures for hearing conditional use applications set forth in zoning ordinance. Is there a representative or the applicant here to testify? Could you step up to the mic?
Yes, Chairman. I'd like to request that I recuse myself from the hearing. The applicant's parents and anybody.
Okay.
Mike.
A member is asked to recuse himself from the hearing on this issue, and therefore he will recuse himself and will be decided by the remaining board members. You may proceed.
As you know, my name is Rhonda Downer. I've applied for a zoning permit to operate a home daycare at my residency for Evergreen Circle, which is in the Brentwood area of Cape Elizabeth. I'd like to maybe explain a little bit of my intentions. I only...
Ms. Downer, can I just ask that you speak into the mic? It's sort of hard to hear. You can adjust it up to you.
My intentions are to work on a part-time basis, caring for a small number of children. I've already been operating for 8 years. I've established clientele for these intended hours of operation. More specifically, my established hours are from 8 to 2 Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, and Friday, and 8 to 5 on Wednesday. I do have 6 children enrolled in my daycare, though all on a part-time basis. I only have 6 children one morning a week. The remaining days are only 2 to 4 children. I have reviewed in great detail the letters and concerns of my neighbors. I have gotten them from Bruce Smith. I'd like to take a little bit of opportunity to maybe address some of their concerns. One of them has been traffic. I strongly feel my business will in no way create any hazardous traffic conditions or endanger children in any way. I myself am a parent of 3, and I am very concerned about traffic in the neighborhood, just as much as anybody else is. My established clientele consists of only 3 families. Combined with my hours of operation, this would mean that I'm one day per week, 3 cars would be entering the Brentwood area. The remaining days would only be 1 to 2 cars entering. I'm not sure if you're aware of Evergreen Circle and the location in Brentwood. It's approximately 100 yards from Brentwood, from the Scott Dyer entrance. The short stretch of Brentwood has no homes on the left side, and on the right side only has 5 homes and a sidewalk. Evergreen Circle itself consists of a large 20-yard turning circle, and any child playing in the circle will be highly visible to any traffic entering the cul-de-sac. As stated before, I've operated daycare for 8 years in the Elizabeth Park area, only a quarter of a mile from where I am right now. And despite multiple other daycares in the area, there have never been, in the 8 years that I've done this, any traffic incidences occurring in those 8 years. I really truly feel that the people who made the, who created the zoning ordinances in the first place and the restrictions were very intelligent, responsible people who did not just throw out six kids or 6 cars, you know, as a basis. I'm sure they thought very strongly and discussed in great detail about the implications of this and felt that it was just not a hazard in the residential areas. The zoning application does allow up to 6 children. Some people may argue that possibly near 6 cars would come into this area. In the 8 years I've operated, I've always taken care of siblings or sets of siblings. I have never taken care of one child per family and having 6 cars or 8 cars or whatever entering, you know, into my area. And just taking care of siblings itself reduces the amount of cars needed. A lot of people have discussed property value as being a concern or the decrease in property value. The possible adverse effect that residing near a home daycare would have on adjacent property through diminished desirability, I feel, is just unwarranted. Adrian Murphy, who is an experienced broker from Century 21, has written a letter to Bruce, and I don't know if everybody's read it or not. She disputes this strongly. And in my own experience, you know, I just sold a house recently in the Elizabeth Park area I sold it for a very competitive price, and within 6 weeks, despite another daycare operating on that same road. In the 8 years that I've operated, both houses on both sides of me have sold, despite my daycare and the one across the street. Others' disputes are the neighborhood and just the feel and look of the neighborhood. One is concerned that the proposed use of my home will alter its appearance in such a way that will be detrimental to the neighborhood or the feel of the neighborhood. I feel this is invalid. The only modification I plan on making to my home is a fence, which is to comply with the zoning requirements. A fenced-in backyard is very familiar to the neighborhood. The people, you know, around me on all sides have fences. Any play equipment already existed prior to purchasing. The outdoor swing set was already there, and that's what I'll be using. In all fairness, I'm not here to change any of the laws. I was told this was a permissible use prior to purchasing the property. And I, again, feel as very strongly that these people who made these requirements and restrictions felt that the home daycare should be allowed because it fits right into the neighborhood and the feel of the neighborhood. I have a difficult time believing that additional few young children or cars in the neighborhood would be diminish anyone's quality of life. In viewing my house, it looks no different than any other house who has children. The children in my care will be supervised, as always, at all times. They will be limited to my property or the public property, the cul-de-sac, which I have heard is permissible under zoning application. We might also enjoy walks around the neighborhood. You know, on the sidewalk, we take walks to the playground and to the library, and we've always respected other people's property and rights. Again, some people feel there's no need for it. I've been operating successfully for 8 years. I feel in operating this home daycare, I'm providing a valuable and much-needed service to this community. In the 8 years I've operated, I've always had more than enough clients and continue to turn down requests on almost a weekly basis. I'm asking one thing of the board today. I watched the meeting that appeared last March 23rd regarding Laura Gibbons' permit, which was denied. To this day, I'm still a little bit puzzled why my application was even brought up. My name was brought up. I strongly feel that linking my application with that of Laura Gibbons is unjust. These are two very separate issues, separate applications, and two different businesses. I would appreciate that you'd only address the concerns and issues affecting my application only. All I really want to do is continue working in a career that has been very rewarding and that I've had for 8 years. This career choice has allowed me the opportunity to remain home with my own three children and to provide the care needed, and they are top priority to me. In addition, it allows me to earn a small amount of income to help with household expenses. I'd like to continue this career and continue to provide this needed and valuable service to the residents of Cape Elizabeth. That's all I can say.
We remain at the podium in case any of the members have any questions for you.
Ms. Downer, could you clarify how long you've been operating this business at this location?
I'm not operating right at this point. I am not operating at 4 Evergreen Circle. I'm not. I did operate, yes, for like maybe 4 weeks until I was told by Bruce Smith that I need to close down. And I closed down.
And the 8 years that you've operated the business were at another home?
It was at another, about a quarter of a mile from where I live right now in the Elizabeth Park area.
Okay. And so you purchased, I just wanted to clarify.
I sold my house and purchased another one.
And when was that?
Excuse me?
When was that?
I closed on this house February 8th.
Thank you.
Any other questions from the board?
I have a question. Why is it that you started this operation without getting the appropriate permits initially? Did you?
I was planning on getting the thing is, I've been operating for 8 years. These people have relied on me. I have been their sole, you know, care provider. It's very difficult to stop doing something you've been doing. These people relied on me. You know, and to stop for 30 days, you know, it's extremely difficult to find quality care in Cape Elizabeth, let alone temporary quality care in Cape Elizabeth. I felt I was obligated to continue to do so. I didn't feel like I was hurting anybody or anything, and I was just hoping that, you know, I'd get my zoning permit and then and then just continue. You know, these people have relied on me for, you know, years to provide care for their kids. It's, you know, they would lose time from work, or they would put their children, have to put them in a temporary care that they didn't have time to investigate or, you know, or thoroughly, you know, look into. You know, this has been a lot of stress on the parents of the children that I've taken care of. And I feel extremely bad that they have to go through this.
I'm not sure it's appropriate for this session, but how come prior to moving you didn't submit an application?
I didn't feel I could until I owned the residency. I didn't know that was something I could do.
I'm under the impression that the town issued several requests for you to cease that you did not acknowledge. Is that?
He wrote me one letter.
Excuse me, just one letter?
He wrote me a letter.
There was a verbal one. And
there was a verbal a one.
Okay. Now, you owned this current residence since when?
We closed February 8th.
February 8th. Okay. And this is the first time you've made application for your new...
I made it about a month and a half ago, yeah. Or yeah. 2 months. I'm not really sure exactly when.
Thank you.
The notification to abutters was sent out March 9th, so it was sometime within a few days prior to that that the application was made. So it was first week in March.
So it was fairly timely then?
I'm not sure what you mean by timely. I mean.
Well, it seems to me that there's been a lot of. Important. It's not appropriate to this an immediate discussion at this time.
Yes, Bruce, is it the residence A area? I didn't see it.
Must be. No, it's sort of
residence B.
Residence C.
Residence C. Thank you.
Caught me off guard there.
Mr. Smith, for the record, could you clarify what your communications have been with the applicant? What your verbal and written communications have been regarding the use and then the application so that we're clear?
You mean the time frame of how she got before the board?
Right.
What happens with home daycares is that the normal procedure is notification or application to the code office, which happens sometime the 1st of March. Prior to that, there was some problem with the daycare operating without the proper approvals, and that's when I wrote the letter, and that, as far as I know, ceased. I didn't get any other phone calls after that anyways. The home daycare permit was submitted under the ordinance. A 30-day waiting period has to take place prior to issuance of any condition of use permit by this office, by the code office. During that 30-day window, the neighbors have an opportunity to express concerns and any other comments they may wish to my office. At the end of that 30-day period, if I feel that the conditional use, that there is enough issues out there that I don't feel comfortable with making the call, then I refer it to the Board of Appeals. Normally, this application would not go to you unless there was no concerns. If there was no concerns, it wouldn't go to you. Only if there's concerns by neighbors that goes to the board. And that's why she's here tonight. The time frame stretched out because we had to wait to 30 days, and then that brought us into the April meeting. Otherwise, it could have been in March.
Okay.
Bruce, can I ask you, when were the concerns brought to your attention?
The concerns?
Didn't you say there was concerns from the neighbor?
Oh, there's the letters you have in the file. At various times through that 30-day window, I got several letters, I think 15 all told. And there's some for and some against.
These came upon notification of abutters?
Notification to abutters has to happen immediately following an application. I'm sorry if I didn't clarify that. And based on that notification, people comment back to the office.
Were the concerns voiced before the application was filed?
There were concerns voiced to my office that there was a home daycare that was operating without a license, and hence the telephone call and then the follow-up letter.
In your application, you submitted this boundary survey. This was dated May of 96, so obviously this is not your boundary survey of the property.
It was one that was probably given.
Did you buy the property from David Boucher?
Boucher, yes.
Boucher?
Yes.
Okay, so that was his. Is your property currently fenced in?
No.
Okay. What I'm looking at is this copy, and it says fenced play area. Is there any area fenced?
He just said I had fenced in what would be, will become a fenced in play area.
Okay, so it's currently not fenced in?
It's currently not fenced in, correct.
Okay. You've said in your presentation that you have been operating a daycare for approximately 8 years?
8 years.
And during these 8 years, I would assume that you were well aware of the Cape Elizabeth ordinance that requires fenced-in areas?
Yes.
For daycare. So you are operating this without a fenced-in area?
At my old residence, or?
This new property. We're talking this new property, 4 Evergreen Circle.
Yes. It was during the wintertime. I couldn't put a fence up during the wintertime.
Well,
I don't know.
I guess my concern is your demonstration for the safety and the well-being of the children, and also your respect for the Cape Elizabeth ordinances. And you were operating it, and it was not fenced in. So you were utilizing another area, an unfenced area, an unpatrolled area, and basically in violation of the ordinance, be that as it may. Another stipulation is adequate lighting shall be provided at the vehicle drop-off and pickup area. This question would be for the code enforcement officer. Bruce, do you feel as though there's adequate lighting there for drop-off and pickup of the children? This is a difficult area because it's like a pie-shaped piece of property, and if they are utilizing the circle for the play area, I have a serious concern that it's might be difficult to adequately light this. So I'm relying upon your judgment to tell me if it's adequately lit or how it might be adequately lit.
Okay. What I will be focused on is if the application is approved, that adequate lighting, as stated on the plan, and adequate fencing, and any other conditions that the ordinance requires or that the Board of Appeals intends to place, will be followed through before a certificate of occupancy will be given. That's not unlike any application before the board where an applicant doesn't want to expend monies without having approval.
Well, I guess my concern is the length of the driveway and where the outdoor light is situated. And I'm going to guesstimate that we're looking at, 1 inch equals 30 feet. 1 inch equals 30 feet. You're looking at a good 50 feet away, and if these kids are playing in the cul-de-sac, the circle, then adequate lighting is not being provided. And that is a concern that I have, especially when we're talking winter months, when it's dark. And
I don't think my children will be playing outside when it's dark. They will not be. So I don't see how that is an issue.
Well, I can't predict whether they are going to play or not.
Well,
I'm just looking at what's before me and the concerns that I have in looking at the property, driving by.
And if you notice my hours of operation too, they're from 8 to 2, 4 days a week. Only one day a week will they be here, even in the wintertime when it's dark. I don't know what else to say.
You've operated for 5 years.
Eight years,
I'm sorry. And you're asking me to trust you in your hours of operation, and yet you move from one property to another without obtaining a license, without having the proper fenced-in property, without having a properly, adequately lit yard.
And
it's hard for me, It's hard for me to trust what you're saying when you've done this in violation of the Cape ordinance. And I'm just presenting my feelings here and what you have done and how you're presenting yourself today.
Well, I feel I'm a very responsible and trustworthy person. I have taken care of children for 8 years. My parents trust me explicitly with their children. I feel I do operate responsibly. I am sorry if I did operate, you know, for a short, I don't know how many weeks it was, until I closed down at Bruce Smith's request. I had a difficult time, I guess. My parents rely on me. They need me so that they can go to work, okay, and not lose their jobs and not lose hours at work as well, worrying about their children and where they are and where and who's taking care of them. They've always relied on me. These children that are in my care right now have only had me as the aid care provider. Now, it's very hard for these young children to go to somebody else on a temporary basis they don't know, nor did they have sufficient time to even get to know. So I feel I was responsible to my parents.
When you bought this property, did you buy it through a real estate agent?
Yes, I did.
All right. Did you have a buyer's broker help you, or did you just buy it?
We bought it on our own.
You bought it on your own through a real estate agent? Through a real estate agent.
The people who sold the house had a realtor, yes.
Okay.
We found the house ourselves.
Okay, but you bought it with a real estate agent representing the property.
Representing that property. Yeah.
Was it the same broker, the selling listing broker, and the selling broker were the same broker, or was it a different broker?
I believe it
Were the two brokers involved?
No.
There was one broker involved?
Yes.
Okay. That person basically is representing the seller of the property and not representing your best interest. The point that I'm making is, when there's a broker involved, they should represent one or the other, or if there's two brokers involved, maybe one's representing the buyer, looking out for your best interest, cautioning you when you purchase a property to make sure things are in order. One of them is, if you're moving from a property with a daycare, they probably should have advised you to make sure that what you're doing is proper and do it basically before you purchase the property. So my concern is whether you were misled when you bought this property or ill-advised when you bought the property. And obviously, no one suggested that you better go see Mr. Smith before you purchase the property to make sure that you can get the daycare in there.
I spoke to Bruce Smith prior to purchasing the property to see if it was permissible in this area, and he said yes, it was.
Did he also tell you the steps you had to go through and tell you what was required of the applicant?
Yes, he did.
Are there any other questions from the board?
I just have one question about, did you plan on having a sign at all?
No.
So the outward appearance of the property would not change at all?
No.
And the property is on a cul-de-sac, so there's no question of stopping traffic to let children on or off?
No.
And you are going to build a fence if allowed to permit and provide adequate lighting. Now, I'm not sure I see the relevance of past infractions. As I read the ordinance, this is a permitted use, right, Bruce?
It's a permitted use.
It's a permitted use. A person has a legal right to run a daycare center subject to the approval of the board. Okay. I have no further questions.
Thank you, Ms. Downer. Is there anyone else who wishes to speak on behalf of the applicant?
I'd like to.
Step to the... I'd like you to state your name and your address, and then you can comment.
Sure. My name is Larry Dupre. I live at 17 Meadow Way. I live next door to Rhonda when she was at 15 Meadow Way. She takes care of my two kids, my 3-year-old, my 1-year-old, and I trust her completely with my kids. Is it Frustation?
Yes.
How you pronounce your name, sir? You had brought up a point that you kind
Excuse
of argued
me, Mr. Chairman, they've got to speak doing. Into that thing. I can't hear.
Will you please speak into the microphone so that we can hear you? And
I felt like
please
you were arguing.
Address your comments to the chair. Okay.
Oh, okay. I felt like there was some argument about what Rhonda's been doing recently with her kids, or with my kids, and while she looked after them for a couple weeks when she first went over there, they were inside, it was in wintertime. You know, she's right, she can't put up a fence in the wintertime. And, you know, I'm a reasonable person. I would have expected that a daycare license that she's had for 8 years could go with her. And sure, subject to approval, but I would imagine you guys would give her some time to do what she has to do. You know. Anyway, and as for adequate lighting, I can't imagine what kind of adequate lighting you would need from 8 to 2. Or from, you know, I'm not sure what relevance adequate lighting has to do with anything. I had addressed a letter to Mr. Smith about some of the concerns that I thought people would have. And she's right. I lived next door for over 2 years, and traffic is minimal. If you sat at your window all day, you might see a couple cars go in and a couple cars go out. As for property values, she's right. The opinion of a licensed certified appraiser is that it has no adverse effect on property values. And when I moved in to Meadow Way, close daycare was a selling point. And for your new neighbors on 2 Brentwood Road, it was a selling point for them too. You know? So, you know, this is a family neighborhood. It's got 3 and 5 bedroom homes. There's gonna be kids there. 20 years ago, I played there with kids. I lived on Brentwood Road, and we played capture the flag in the cul-de-sacs, and we played dodgeball in the streets. And, you know, you have to expect children to be here. You know, again, Rhonda takes care of my 2 kids, and she takes care of them excellent. And I just thought you'd want to know that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Are there any other members of the public who'd like to speak on behalf of the applicant? Again, please state your name, and if you've submitted anything in writing, let us know that.
No, I have not. Okay. My name is Dawn Munson. I'm Rhonda's sister. I live at 35 Highview Road. I'd just like to say that I'm with Rhonda every day. I usually go over and help her every day, unless I'm doing have to do something. But I'm there with the kids, with Rhonda every day, so there's usually actually 2 people helping to supervise the kids. I'm not an employee or a part of Rhonda's, you know, babysitting or daycare team, but I am there. I go out in the cul-de-sac with the kids. These are only ages 1 to 4, so somebody has to usually be there in the cul-de-sac while they're riding their bikes because they need help. They want, you know, to play ball. They want help with that. So if any traffic ever comes, we tell them, get to the side of the road. And so there's somebody always supervising those kids. I mean, we're not more than a feet, you know, a foot away from these kids when they're playing. We don't let them go on the other people's property. If a ball happens to roll over, you know, we go get it and we get off the property. So I'm just trying to address the concerns of the safety and the property of other people around them and the noise level. 1 to 4-year-olds don't make a whole lot of noise, but, you know, if they do, that's kids playing, and that's all I'd like to say. Thank you.
Any questions from the board? Thank you. Anyone else like to speak on behalf of the applicant? Sir? Again, please state your name, and if you've submitted anything beforehand, let us know that as well.
Good evening. Can you hear that okay?
No, not really.
How's that?
Yes.
All right. My name is Mike Tranfaglia. I live at 6 Evergreen Circle. I don't live with Rhonda. but I am a next-door neighbor, and my property is directly contiguous with her home. I also wrote a letter. I don't remember the date. And I wrote that letter in support of Rhonda's application because it came to my attention that there were several issues that were basically flying around, one of them being safety. One of them was somewhat of an innuendo about property value. The safety issue had to do with, I believe, the number of vehicles. And as been stated tonight, the number of vehicles with Rhonda's home care is minuscule. It's 2 to 3. The hours of operation are 8 to 2. I can tell you there are multiple home businesses in the Brentwood area that bring in multiple cars during the course of the day. I don't think it's the number of cars that are a problem at all. I think actually the problem in the Brentwood area is the speed of the existing population of vehicles, which universally go above the posted speed limit in that neighborhood. And living directly next door for the limited time that she was operating, I had no trouble with my children being outside. I didn't have any trouble getting into my driveway because of the vehicles or people parking in the circle. The second issue is basically one just of a gestalt feeling of property values. And I really think that is totally an inappropriate argument. If we could put things in perspective here, this good person has been operating a business and also a family for multiple years. And you said a quarter mile. I think of it more as maybe four city blocks. Four city blocks for 8 years. No complaints from neighbors, no real estate agents having trouble selling their homes, no extra rescue calls to Meadowway Lane. And she was essentially, it's like buying a home, it's transferring debt. She was moving her business. She made, it was nothing done in secret. She contacted you, Mr. Smith, and said, I'm doing this, and it's ordinary, and there was no law against it. It's February 8th, the ground was frozen. You can't dig a fence post. If anything, as a next door neighbor, the appearance of the grounds has improved tremendously in their short time living there and plans of fixing it up. For the life of me, how there can be any problem or basis for her not to continue what she has been doing very well, it escapes my, I don't have those logical circuits to see where there can be objection to that. It's four blocks away from what's been happening for 8 years. Is something magical happen when we cross Scott Dyer? I'm a little bit, I guess I'll try and keep my emotions out of this, but I'm a little bit upset and I'm a little bit mad because I think someone is being treated, not intentionally, but not very neighborly. And I can only say that I support her application and I support her as a neighbor.
Thank you. Are there any questions from the board members? There's another letter in the materials we have from Marianne Trimfaglia. Is that your wife?
Yes.
Okay. Just note that for the record. Is there anyone else who'd like to speak on behalf of the applicant?
Hi, my name is Mark Hare. I live at 68 Brentwood Road, which would be two doors or three doors down from Evergreen Circle. My wife and I both wrote a letter. Well, it's the same letter. It should be in your files. I just want to go over the same stuff. The only thing I wanted to add is that we are parents of a young child, and we think it would be great to have a young daycare person like Rhonda in case we'd like to have that opportunity someday to send our child or future children to her place rather than having to take someplace else. My wife works part-time, and it's very hard to find someone very quality daycare. And this would help, at least in our opinion, our neighborhood out. Maybe there'd be other future people that would like to use Rhonda. Therefore, it wouldn't really increase the traffic, and it would really add to the neighborhood. That's all I have to say.
Thank you. Are there any questions from the board members? Thank you. Any other members of the public wish to speak on behalf of the applicant?
My name is Marianne Tranfalia, and I live at 6 Evergreen Circle. I'm a direct abutter to Rhonda and Dwayne Downer's property, and I sent a letter to Mr. Smith a few weeks ago. I have just a few comments to make so as to not to be repetitive. Rhonda has cared for our children for 3 years on a part-time basis, and if you've ever had to look for a home daycare-based person of good quality, who takes care of your children the way that you would know how difficult that is and how grateful one feels to have found somebody. Rhonda is an excellent daycare provider. She watches my children on occasion. At this point, they're in school full-time, so it's very much an occasional basis. I don't have concerns regarding property value. I don't have concerns regarding the noise of children. I do not find that objectionable. However, I do have concerns when rumors spread that a daycare will reduce property value and these things become spread through the neighborhood without a basis in fact. And I think that when you make your decision and when you look at the letters of support and the letters of opposition and the people who have showed up in support and opposition, I hope that somewhere in this, common sense will play a part. That when a person has a home-based business operating for 8 years successfully, so successfully that her business is completely word of mouth, and has many, many families who rely on her for care, that you can see that within our neighborhood, a large circle where many children play, that I cannot foresee a safety problem. Just this afternoon, we had 9 or 10 children running through the bike paths of the neighborhood picking up trash in preparation for our neighborhood cleanup this Sunday afternoon. If that noise bothers someone, so be it. When people talk about who the children are in Rhonda's daycare, I have concerns that anyone really knows who those children are. I do, but I'm sure that many people in the opposition don't know which children she cares for and which children may be visiting, maybe at my house and visiting next door. I think this whole unfortunate situation has been at the very least unneighborly, and I hope when you make your decision, you will take into consideration the number of parents who rely on Rhonda for her daycare. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any questions? Thank you. Anyone else who wishes to speak on behalf of the applicant?
Hi, my name is Dorothy Stack. I live at 24 Brentwood Road. You have a letter in your file that my husband and I sent to you. My property does not abut Rhonda's, but I use the common grounds that are behind her house. I have 3 small children in our neighborhood, and I would just like you to consider that Rhonda's request is within the zoning ordinance. If you have met her children or met Rhonda or her husband Dwayne, you'd realize that they're a wonderful couple. She has wonderful children who are not running wild and unsupervised throughout the neighborhood. We're very lucky. We live in a neighborhood that has older people and younger people and many children. And many young families are attracted to our neighborhood because we have 3 and 4 bedroom homes close to the school. I'd like you to recognize that the children that you may hear complaints about later on for people who object to Rhonda having a daycare are not necessarily Rhonda's children or Rhonda's daycare children. They may be children that live in the neighborhood that ride their bikes or go to play. We're very lucky in this town to have a great neighborhood that kids can go ride their bikes and go have a ball game in the cul-de-sac or something like that. So please consider that Rhonda has only lived there since February 8th, that her children are 8, I think 6, and Jacob is probably 2. We used to have older children who lived in that house who attracted a lot of kids from outside of the neighborhood that may have had ball games or snowball fights or something like that. This is not Rhonda's children that you may hear about later, and you may want to ask Rhonda about what her children do in the neighborhood. Thank you for your time.
Are there any questions for staff? Thank you. Anyone else wish to speak on behalf of the applicant? Are there any members of the public who wish to speak in opposition to the application? Sir, if you could, why don't we take this gentleman first? Please identify yourself, your address, and if you've submitted anything to Bruce or the board, let us know.
We submitted a letter. First, my name is Thomas Summers, and I live at 39 Brentwood Road. We are directly behind Mrs. Downer's property. and our property line abuts their property the full length. And our patio and the back of our house is about 50 to 60 feet from where the children would be playing in their backyard. I think, I'm assuming that all of you have that letter of the 24th, so I'm not going to go into detail. It pretty much explains our position. But I would like to pick up a couple points here with respect to standards for conditional use approval and also with respect to the permit requirements, fencing in particular. I'm sure that Mrs. Downer is a wonderful daycare provider, and certainly from what I've heard here tonight that she's done a great job at that, but that really isn't the issue. The issue has to do with standards for conditional approval and with the permit standards. And I want to say, Mrs. Downer, we have absolutely no animosity about this. I just want to come up here and explain my point of view. Now, there are three points out of the six that are listed here that I think are relevant. The first one is the proposed use will not create hazardous traffic conditions. I'll leave that to the others here who live in Evergreen Circle. We don't have that particular traffic problem that they do have. But I would say that of the five houses around there, if I were parking my car in my garage and backing out into Evergreen Circle with a bunch of little kids playing around, I would be scared to death. And I would be very seriously worried about that. But I will leave that to the other residents to expand on that point. Now, it has been said here that with respect to the value of adjacent properties, that they would not be affected. There is a market. It includes people with kids, people without kids, and retired people like my wife and myself. Now, I suggest to you that if I have a retired couple who want a relatively quiet place to retire to work in the garden, to sit and read perhaps, do other things around, and if I take them around my property and behind me, 50 feet away, there's kind of organized chaos going on. And little kids do make noise, believe me. We've lived in that area for 24 years, and I think the principal means of communication is somewhere up here at a high level and a high volume. Now, we don't mind if it comes now and then, the way kids play. My goodness, I've helped kids out of trees who got up in the trees behind our property. I fixed their bicycle chains. I've done a lot of things for these kids. And we don't mind that at all. But when you have an organized playground 50 feet behind your house, that is something different from the rather intermittent kind of noise you get when kids are playing out in the street. So I do honestly think that this would affect our property and will eliminate certain groups of buyers from our market. Now, the other thing I want to point out here is that the proposed site plan and layout are compatible with adjacent property. I don't think this is true. I don't think a home daycare facility or use is compatible. When Brentwood West was designed and built some 30 or more years ago, it was designed as a single family residence area. And if you will take a look at residency requirements, which require something like 20,000 square feet, you will find that nobody in the Brentwood West area has a piece of property that is compatible with that. Most of our properties are from 10 to 11, maybe a few 12,000 square feet. And another thing that can be pointed out with respect to frontages, setbacks, we simply do not conform. We do not meet any of the requirements of the residency area. We're all non-conforming. And with small lots like that, and with the narrow streets, the way the place was laid out as a single-family residence area, you can see that there's just not any room for commercial activities. The streets are 20 feet wide, the kids play in them, and it's their only really good playground if they're using wheels of any kind. So I just can't see the intrusion of commercial activities of this sort in a single-family residence area that is well-balanced in many ways, and it's a great place to live. I would hate to see it change. Now, the other point I want to make has to do with the fencing, which is a requirement. There is no fence there, except there is a short section of fence, I think, between your property and number two. It's a 6-foot-high stockade fence. The rest of the property is totally unfenced. Now, running at the back of the Downer property is a pathway, which is deeded to the Brentwood West Association. It runs over a drainage easement area. Now, the kids use that pathway quite a lot, particularly in the summertime. And they're kids who go down there, racing down there on their bicycles. It's a challenge. And sometimes, if somebody gets in the way, it's just too bad. And I think that if there is no fence there, it will be particularly dangerous for the little kids to get out into that area. People walk their dogs there, and there's a possibility of contact between dog and child. So I would hope that before a permit is issued, that the fence requirement, and we suggest a continuation of that 6-foot-high stockade fence, which would keep the kids in. Little kids are pretty strong, and they can reach up and pull over themselves over 4-foot fences. And I would think that a 6-foot stockade fence, if the permit is to be issued, that it be put up and in place before the permit is issued. I think I've covered practically everything I want to cover here, and I'll leave it go at that.
Mr. Summers, I have a question. Do you have any factual basis for your belief that real estate values would be affected?
I have no factual basis. But
it's just a belief on your part.
I'm going to argue here as an economist and say I have a certain market which consists of a variety of peoples. And what I'm saying, if someone has adjacent to them a playground, that will automatically knock out certain groups of people, like retirees who want a relative degree of quietness. They will be knocked out of the market simply because they say, I'm sorry, we don't want to like a bunch of kids organized playground in our backyard. So that is my logic. And in fact, when we've talked or chatted with real estate brokers, pretty wishy-washy. They're on both sides of the argument. So I can't give you any facts that it will actually decrease the value. I'll let you know when we sell the house.
Any questions from board members? Thank you, Mr. Summers.
Thank you.
Anyone else wish to speak in opposition to the application?
Good evening. My name is Nicholas Young, and I live at 80 Brentwood Road in Cape Elizabeth. And I haven't met Mrs. Downer, and I really have no desire to stand in her way of making a living. But my wife and I were away when we received the notice that the application had been received, and so we sent a letter in opposition. And I think Mr. Summers has pretty much covered my objections, and mostly about property values. And we've lived in the neighborhood for over 20 years, and certainly I'm not sure that I would have purchased my home had there been a daycare center in the neighborhood at that time. And so I have a feeling that Mr. Summers' arguments are are possibly true and that it does limit the market. And with all due respect to my friends and neighbors, Mark and Mike, I do disagree with them, and so that's all I have to say.
Any questions for Mr. Young? Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else from the public wish to speak in opposition?
My name is Dick Herman, and I live at 10 Evergreen Circle, right across the street from the subject house. I believe...
You submitted a letter?
Yes, I did.
You can go ahead.
Pardon?
You can go ahead. I just wanted to make that note.
There are two major areas of concern in my mind at this point. Is the hazard created by the additional traffic? And we can stand here all night and parade this side of the room and that side of the room up here and say there is or isn't an additional hazard. The fact of the matter is we have children playing in the street. Everybody agrees with that. You put additional traffic through there, you create a problem. As Mr. Summers said, backing out of my driveway will be a nightmare. I happen to be the former owner of 4 Evergreen Circle. So I'm somewhat familiar with the property. I sold the property principally because the backyard is what I considered wetland. You cannot fence in that property so that it'll be properly utilized by children during the spring or the fall. This year we're lucky it's not raining much, but the years in which it rains, that backyard is flooded. Where will the children go? The children will go into the street. They've already admitted the children have to play in the street. Again, traffic hazard because the children are in the street. As to property values, I would agree with Mr. Summers that when you restrict your total market, you're obviously bringing the value of your house down. If there's 100 people out there and 50 of them happen to be of retirement age, then X number of those are going to say, I'm not interested, because they just don't want to put up with it. Now, I was there during the month in which they operated kind of illegally, and I can go on and on and on about some of the episodes. You know, it's fine to say that she's been doing it for 8 years and hasn't had problems. She did it for 8 days, and she had 2 complaints. This gentleman says she never had complaints. Myself and Nancy Anger on the corner. The children were unsupervised one afternoon, out in the middle of the circle, in the middle of Brentwood Road, getting into trouble. That's because there's no fenced-in backyard. The other thing we have to look at, is there a real need in this area for this daycare? It just happens to be that there is an excellent daycare center just 100, 200 yards up the street, right across from the Viking, with a big sign out in front that has openings. And as much as we'd like to think that there won't be a problem, when you create children in the street, additional children in the street with more traffic, there's going to be problems. Just to tell you what happened one morning, you know, it would kind of curl your ears. One mother coming to drop off their child started from the corner of Scott Dyer, and I measured the footage and clocked it. 42 miles an hour. And this is a matter of 480 feet. That's pretty fast. Now, if there had been any children there, which coincidentally, there is a bus stop right on the corner there. Now, what would happen? You can't tell me that there isn't a hazard. Also, as far as values go, if someone was to come over to my house right now and take a look at it, they would devalue it. And maybe in my eyes, but if it's in my eyes, it's in everybody's eyes. 4 Evergreen Circle right now has bicycles, toys, and these are her own children's things, just laying around. Now, if we bring in six more children with all those toys, where are they going to be left? Right in the front yard? That's an appearance that affects value. And you get any realtor in the world in here, and I'm sure they'll back me up on that, that there is going to be a definite effect on value when, in effect, one piece of property is being treated different than everybody else.
Are there any questions for Mr. Herman? Thank you.
I have a question. Would your concerns be allayed if the board put as a conditional use, which we are empowered to do, provisions that require the children be kept in the backyard and no outside leaving of toys? I can substantiate the gentleman's story. I drove by the property and there was a substantial number of toys in the front yard. But I'm asking, if the children are confined or are not, as a condition of use, we say, if you can operate this home daycare, subject to the condition that the children are not permitted to play in the cul-de-sac area, in the vehicular traffic area, and that no outside, no toys are left outside, would that allay your concerns?
That may help on the valuation issue. That's not going to change the traffic hazard problem. And it also is not addressing the fact that if you want to go down there, you'll see that it's wetlands back there, and the children won't be able to play back there. And I hate to tell you, when they put up the fence back there, because of the easements of the Brentwood West Association, any fence they put up is going to have to be 15 feet away from the property line, or away from the current fences. They can't block the pass. So therefore, you're going to have like a mouse's maze back there. And what's that going to look like? Again, affecting property values. It's just not going to look very good. And again, that's going to have an adverse effect. And unfortunately, no matter how you look at this, everything becomes an adverse effect on the property. And I have to say that that translates to a decrease in property values.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who'd like to speak in opposition to the application?
Hi, I'm Teresa Fox, and I live at 35 Brentwood. And I just want to say that I am vice president of the association, too, and I have had a lot of people address concerns to me. And I'm also in a butter, and I know Rhonda and Dwayne are great people. We bought a used car from them, and we've known them for a while. This issue has caused a lot of problems in the neighborhood, a lot of turmoil, and it's really divided the neighborhood. And that's been very difficult for everybody that lives in our neighborhood. And I want to say that it has been said that, in a way, that people that are opposed to this daycare maybe are being tagged as unneighborly, and that's not true. They're just looking out for their own interests, and I would hope that that is not how Wander and Drain see this. People are not trying to be unneighborly to them. They just have the right to voice their opinion. The other thing I wanted to say was Mr. Frustaci had asked about concerns before they moved into the neighborhood as far as what the realtor may have said, and I personally had people call me before the closing because they were asking me if her permit was transferable from where she lived in Elizabeth Park to Brentwood West. And I personally spoke with Bruce on several occasions before the closing, and also was advised by Bruce to go ahead and call the realtor who lives in our neighborhood. And I personally spoke with her to see if she had advised them that it was not transferable and they would have to reapply. So I just wanted to share that information, that there was some discussion about that.
Are there any questions?
I can see the room is divided between pros and cons. Is there any compromise that you people, as a member of the association, can propose to try to get us over a hump here, or to try to ease the pain on both sides?
Well, we did have a meeting with both she and another daycare provider earlier, and it mainly, it did focus on part of Rhonda's, but it also focused on the larger larger daycare that had also been asked to get a permit. And so that was a little while ago.
We're talking about this one before us tonight.
Right. No, she was part of that meeting, but there has not been a meeting since. So I really can't speak to that issue.
All right. You people haven't come up with any suggestions and limitations, hours of operation, excluding the kids from the circle?
Lots of different things were tossed around as far as maybe if this was approved, that the hours of operation would be part of that contract, so it wasn't that if she decided to go till 5 that she could, that it was written in the permit that it would be 8 to 2 if that was approved. There were certain things like that that were discussed at the meeting, but none of them were, we didn't come to any agreement on any of them.
Okay, what
they were just suggestions.
What we've heard tonight is the reduced value of real estate, and I don't think that that's been substantiated.
I think that came from someone that is here that had a realtor looking at her house and made that remark to her. Her house was for sale in the area.
Well, are there any brokers in the house? Do we want to really trust what they say or what they offer?
I'm not sharing either way. I'm just sharing what was told.
The other comment, and that was touched on, I think, by two, is the traffic concern. And I can see backing out of the driveways from the outer properties into the focal point, the cul-de-sac, would be a problem, especially in the winter months when it's dark, or maybe even in the early hour mornings. And I'm wondering if limiting the kids from playing in the cul-de-sac to daylight hours would appease people. And I'm asking you because you mentioned your capacity in the Neighborhood Association and mm-hmm. What you might have heard.
The current witness finished testifying.
What I'm looking for is common ground.
Yeah.
Neighborly has been mentioned, and I'm a former resident of Brentwood. Mm-hmm. It is a great neighborhood. I don't know whether you still have your parties once a year, or you know, your annual garage sales or not, but it's a nice place to live, mm-hmm. and I'm just looking for something that we might be able to, you know, help us out.
I think people would love to have a compromise reached. I think that would be best for everyone in the neighborhood. And, you know, hours of operation is one of the things that we discussed. In my letter that I sent to the board and some that others have spoken here, the 6-foot stockade fence would also be a compromise if the daycare was permitted. That seems to be something that has been mentioned by several people, some that are here and some that aren't here. Noise level has been an issue, but, you know, I have no idea how you could make this permit speak to that. So those were a couple things. So the hours and the fence were two things that I know people had mentioned to me.
I'll just make an observation. It's been mentioned that people have lived there for 20 years or so, and I think that's been the case. People moved into that neighborhood, loved it, stayed there for an extended period of time. And what it appears is what's happening is some of those houses are being sold to younger families with kids. So you're in a transitional period, and younger children are being moved into the neighborhood with all the problems that are associated, joys, problems, whatever.
Well, I know that my neighbors, who spend a tremendous amount of their time in their backyard, and it's their pride and joy, are not complaining about the daycare as far as Rhonda's children. And they know that kids come, they make noises, they have toys. They're fine with that. It's the additional kids that is their concern, and the additional noise level that doesn't enable them to enjoy their backyard.
One last question. What are the age of the children? What are the age of the children in this daycare?
1 to 4.
1 to 4. Okay. And is that constant, 1 to 4?
That's what I have written down.
Any other questions?
Yeah, just to ask a question by way of making a point. Are you aware that in your residence, in Brentwood, which is residency, not only home care, home daycare is a permitted use, but farm and fish markets and boat repair facilities are also permitted uses?
Yes, we found that out the last meeting.
Enough.
And Mr. LaValle is president of the Brentwood West Association, so if you have any questions for...
Well, thank you. I will be glad to recognize Mr. LaValle if he wishes to address the board. Thank you.
I wasn't going to speak tonight because of my role, but I am president of the association and really want to keep that separate because it's my understanding that the property is zoned for this use. And my concern is that we start setting too many limits and I think a compromise is a wonderful idea, and I think, you know, neighborly, and it is a wonderful neighborhood and couldn't be happier being there. But when we start hearing compromises of not leaving toys outside in the front yard, which I understand, I have children, I try to clean up my yard every day, but if there's toys in the front yard, I don't want a letter written to the town addressing that. That's not the type of neighborhood that it has been historically. As far as property values, I think if we really statistically looked, I've been there about 4 years, and I'm just sitting back here, counted 10 homes that have been sold in those 4 years, and all 9 of the 10 have had children. The one house that sold recently without children happens to be a kindergarten teacher in town and plan on having children. I would like it if no one had dogs. I would like it if no one gave piano lessons in town. I would like it if did daycare. But if it's permitted use, I think we need to go with that. And I guess that's my feeling as not the president, but as a resident.
Is this letter that we have?
Oh, yeah, sorry. I did. My wife and I wrote a letter.
Okay. Are there any questions? Thank you.
Thanks.
Any other members of the public wish to speak on this at all? I'd like to give the applicant an opportunity very briefly to address anything new that has come up, and actually like to start off with a question, if I could, of you. Will you be able to operate this home daycare with the restriction that children are not allowed to play in the cul-de-sac?
I don't think that's constitutionally right. It's public property, and I feel I'm allowed. We do go for walks, too, and we have to walk through the cul-de-sac to even do that, to go to the playground. These are some of the activities we've always done for 8 years successfully, and I don't see how that can be legally done.
I'm not sure how that could be enforced. It'd be kind of rough.
I'm sorry, can I go?
Yeah, please.
I guess a couple concerns. One of them is addressed to Mr. Herman. I don't know him. He does not know me. He does not know my family. He does not know the children, not only my personal children, but the children in my care. He has not made it a point to come over and speak to me or address any of these concerns to me. I truly feel that his concerns about unsupervised children is invalid. It is not my concern. There are numerous children playing in this area. He does not know which ones are mine or which ones are the kindergarten. I mean, just anyone that are in just, you know, his residence here. So I guess I just wanted to address that. Also, the fence, I don't really know why it seems to be a concern with people about me putting up a fence and how that is going to be a problem is along the bike path. There's fences along the other side of the bike path with 3 different houses right there in a row, fences right along it with no problems. I see no problems in putting up a fence along the easement, you know, obeying all the easement and zoning, property lines, everything. I see no problems. My backyard is not wetlands. I wanted to make that clear as well, too. As for a need, I have been doing it for 8 years, and there is a need. I don't know how one man with grown children has any idea what the need is for daycare in the community. Yes, there is the Youth Academy that is operating on Scott Dyer Road. I am not really aware of that. I've spoken to some people about it, and they have told me that this operation is only for 5 years and older. My children are 1 and 4, so they would not even be eligible for something like that. As of property values, again, I bought my house here. If there was any restrictions that said in Brentwood area that I could not run a daycare, I would not have bought that home, and that home could still be on the market today. So these are restrictions as well that would restrict anybody buying a house.
Are there any follow-up questions from the board limited to new matters raised?
I just wanted to clarify about the backyard and the question of to what degree it's wetlands. And I think the real question is, to what degree it's an appropriate backyard to have children playing in of that age group at all times a year, assuming that it's fenced off, assuming that the majority of your activities are in that backyard. Could you comment on that?
I see no problems with it. It's dry now. My children play in it. I have a nice swing set. It's a large area. A lot of it's a lot of trees, so there is an area where it's all grassed and everything, but there's also an area where it's not. The previous owners had cut down a lot of trees, left sawdust, left logs, everything there, and we're in the process of cleaning all that up now. But I see no problems with it. My children right now play in it fine, and as well as some of the kids in the neighborhood as well. So I don't see that as a concern.
Another question of clarification. Some other people have commented on the suggestion that you make sure it's a 6-foot stockade fence. Is that your intention? You haven't said what kind of fence you'd be planning to put in.
I've discussed it with my husband. We have not come up with an agreement on what kind of fence we want on. I didn't know that I had to put up a zoning. I have to put up a stockade fence. Is that part of the zoning application, Mr. Smith? I don't know. Do I have to put up a stockade fence?
It just has a fenced-in area. It doesn't go into detail.
You know, there's only one other person that abuts my property that has a stockade fence, too, really. The other one is a split. I don't really know what it's called. It's a split kind of fence, so I don't really know why they want a stockade fence. I don't see the reasoning behind it. I personally don't like the looks of a stockade fence, so it probably would not be my choice.
Any other questions from the board?
Yeah, I have not for the applicant, but for code enforcement officer. It says a fenced-in area.
That's correct.
But are there suggested types of fences? If she's talking a split rail fence.
I didn't say that's what I was going to put up. I said there are others.
Yeah, but I'm just wondering if there's some limitations on a fence. There's a reason for for a fence, and that's to keep the kids inside. Is that correct?
I assume so. I assume it would be to have a supervised area, yes.
Okay. In your experiences as the code enforcement officer, what type of fence have other people been putting up?
I've seen all types, from a picket fence to a chain link to a stockade. There's no consistency necessarily.
But every fence that's been installed is to keep children inside the area?
I would have to make that assumption. It doesn't tell us in the ordinance. I would assume that's the case.
What does the state require?
I have no idea.
Excuse me, what? I didn't hear that last part.
What does the state require for a fence?
They don't require any specific fence.
No, not in your category as home daycare, but when you go from 6 to 12, I think they require a type of fence.
I'm not sure if it's any specific kind.
Mr. Houghton?
I have a question for the code enforcement officer. Going back to the fencing again, is the applicant required to tell you what kind of fence she's going to put in, or do you have to actually see that fence before it's up?
The only requirement that I have required is that a fence be up before a certificate of occupancy is given.
Now, would you authorize a split rail fence?
For lack of guidance in the ordinance for something better, yes, I would. I don't think the authority, the ordinance does not give me authority to specify a particular fence. Okay. Although if I went out there and saw a flower garden fence a foot high, I probably would.
Well, it's split rail for all intents and purposes is a foot high too.
Yeah.
Okay.
It does, it's not a fence. Yeah,
but we can correct, if we approve this, we can correct that with a condition.
Yeah.
We can qualify it rather.
Any other questions for the applicant? Thank you. With that, I will close the public hearing portion, public comment portion of this hearing. I would open the issue to discussion among the board.
Aside from the fence issue, which again, as I just to reiterate, if we approve this, I think we need to insert a qualification as regard the fencing, and I'm a little bit surprised that the ordinance does not indicate that it should be a fence that a young person can't climb over through, out, around, or bypass.
There is no fence that a young person can't climb.
Well, how about we can electrify it?
Barbed wire.
Razor wire. All right. I've listened to the pros and cons here, and it just seems to me that 90% of the people are not opposed to this. Those who seem to have a negative attitude, I personally feel kind of discount all the racket that goes on around them from the other children. I mean, if this is a neighborhood where Mr. LaValle said, in 4 years, 10 families have moved in, 9 of them have children. I mean, these kids aren't quiet. Certainly the kids in my neighborhood are not quiet. I have one young man who sits and kicks a ball against the garage door. It can drive you nuts after a while, and you go down and you talk to him and say, hey, he's up on it. And it works. I just find it very difficult to find a reason to vote against this thing because it is children. Now, I've driven down through Brentwood for many years, in the years I've lived in Cape Elizabeth, and you're going to find the driver that speeds, there's no question about that. There are many drivers, and that's why I think a lot of us go to Chief Pickering and say it's time to slow things down a little bit. You're always going to have an individual who loses sight of the fact that there are children around. Now, that's one of the largest cul-de-sacs I've ever driven through. And I would think that every day of the week, whether the daycare is in operation or not in operation, driving out, backing out, however you get out of your driveway, there are apt to be children around. And when I came down through, while I'll admit there were no children at that particular time, there were lots of kids coming down Brentwood from school. So I feel it's a little bit, I'm not as concerned about traffic as a lot of people are. I think you recognize you're in a child neighborhood and you drive accordingly. And I don't think 4 to 6 additional children or 6 children or 3 or 4 vehicles is going to impact on that neighborhood.
Any other comments from the board?
My view is, I don't agree with the law that allows home daycare, fish markets, or boat repair facilities in residential C neighborhoods, or residential B for that matter. But I'm not a legislator. Nobody voted to me. I've been given a responsibility to interpret the ordinances as they were written by the elected representatives of the town and to apply them as fairly and reasonably as I can. If the town, democratically, through its representatives, says this is a permitted use, then person has a right to use their property according to that permitted use. And they've given some oversight to this board to assure certain provisions are met, including fencing, I think, and minimizing impact. I disagree with the applicant who said that she has a constitutional right to use the cul-de-sac area as a play area for the children. I think it's well within the board's purview to any responsibility to restrict the use of that area. I mean, at the town, why do we have a fenced-in area? We have a fenced-in area to prevent the children from going into traffic, which is clearly probably the most dangerous place for them to be is. So if we, if the provision says there has to be a fenced-in area, then to me the rationale is to keep them out of the traffic. And that can be, I think it's a perfectly legitimate condition to place on the applicant's operation of this facility. She doesn't have a constitutional right to operate this facility. She has a constitutional, she has a municipal right to operate a facility subject to the conditions imposed upon this board, imposed by this board to ensure that the spirit of the law is complied with. So I'm in favor, I feel compelled to vote in favor of the permit, but I would also impose certain conditions about whether children will be allowed to play and have it basically an effective fencing, not a decorative fence, to assure that they do not wander off the property.
How would you restrict the activity in the cul-de-sac?
How would I restrict it?
By placing
children
hours?
Will, confined, will play in area not open to vehicular traffic. I think that's a perfectly reasonable constraint.
For the whole day?
Yeah. Why should we don't allow children to play in the street? I mean, be a parent might, but a person who's taking care of other people's children, I don't think should allow the children to play in the street. That's why we have the provision for a fenced-in area.
Yes, I understand that. But I probably would be more liberal than you and restrict it from certain hours. But you can make a motion if you'd like, and we'll see what happens. The other thing is I think we definitely have to spell out that the fence will be of such a nature that children cannot easily get through it.
Any other comments?
I would actually, in terms of my comments, ask a question of the board, since I'm a new board member. In previous conditional use permits that have come before the board for daycare fencing, has there been a stipulation set on what kind of fencing for each conditional use that comes before it? What amount of activity is within the fenced area? It seems to me very reasonable to do field trips or walks around the neighborhood as long as they're well supervised, and that I believe state law would certainly not find any conflict with that kind of use as long as the children were carefully supervised. I think it makes me uneasy to be placing stipulations on that. At the same time, I think that if we look at the standards for conditional use approval, once the fence is put up, this application meets all of those requirements and apparently meets all of those requirements that have been held for every daycare that's been allowed to be permitted for conditional use in this town. So I have, although I certainly understand and respect the concerns of the neighbors, I think what we have here is a situation where someone continued a use from one residence to another without with a lapse in a permit and with a lapse in a fence. But that's past, and we're talking about the future here, and I would be uneasy with, unless there's a precedence for all other permits, with putting other special conditions on this.
Can I respond, Mr. Chairman?
Please do.
I guess I've been involved for 3 or 4 years. We've been pretty much the same time, haven't we, Joe? And we've had 4 daycares that have come up. We've had the Scott Dyer. We had Tar Box up there on Shore Road. We're on way down Shore Road, and the one that was turned down on Grover, if I recollect. But it seems to me that in each instance, a fence has been up prior to coming before this board, so it has not been a question mark. Now, I stand to be corrected on Scott Dyer because I don't remember the fence down there opposite the Viking. But I know the one on Shore Road had a stockade fence up. Tar Box had a fence out back. I mean, it was the old Tar Box property, right just below the Methodist Church. So it hasn't been an issue before.
No, it has not been an issue, so we haven't had limitations or had a discussion. That's why we were surprised the ordinance didn't address it. But I think the intent for a fenced-in area is to keep the kids contained in that area, and that's the way we've interpreted for the 3 or 4 years that we've been on the board.
Yeah. Mr. Chairman, may I raise a point? Fence is not defined in the ordinance, but I think that our interpretive powers as a board allows us to interpret a fence as an effective barrier and not as a mere decoration.
I also think we have some latitude in light of the fact this is a request for a conditional use permit, and we have fairly broad powers in putting conditions on that use.
I would further recommend someplace before we get done tonight that we charge the code enforcement officer with going to the council with amendment of these laws, that these regulations, which will define a fence and specifically define a fence as regards the home daycare and daycare facilities.
One last comment from me, Mr. Chairman. I still have a concern about adequate lighting in the vehicle drop-off area and pickup area. And again, I'm concerned about the winter months and the age of these kids. And if they are restricted to the house or the rear yard during the late afternoon hours, that will appease me, satisfy my concern. I'm not I think demanding as Bob is, and suggesting that the kids be completely excluded from playing on the cul-de-sac. But I certainly would like to see it restricted to certain hours.
Any other comments? Is there a motion?
I'll move that the application for a home daycare permit be improved, subject to the conditions. You want to introduce those as amendments and vote on them separately and then vote on the whole package, Mr. Chairman? Would that be the most efficient way?
I think that would be the most efficient way, because there might be some discussion about that.
Right. And I guess I'd ask for a second to my amendment and then allow people to make a second to the motion and now allow people to introduce amendments as they should.
I second the motion.
Any discussion?
Just a clarification. You're making a motion to approve?
Making a motion to approve.
With no amendments?
No, I'm getting that on the table. Now, in order of business, I submit that the appropriate motion now is to introduce amendments to that, is to amend that motion subject to the conditions that the board finds appropriate. So if you think as a condition, you may amend the motion subject to.
Before we vote on the motion, we're going to entertain amendments to the motion,
right.
Correct?
That's fine.
There's been a second to the motion, so if there are any suggestions for an amendment to the motion, we can entertain those now.
I would amend the motion to qualify the fenced-in play area being of such type of fencing that a child cannot easily get over through or around.
I second the amendment.
I would be comfortable with that as well.
Any other proposals for amendments?
Do you want to vote on that one?
Okay. All in favor of the amendment to the motion? None opposed? The motion is still on the table with the amendment. We haven't voted on the motion yet. Are there any other amendments now?
Yeah, I move that the operator of the daycare center assure that the children do not play in areas open to vehicular traffic.
Is there a second? Hearing none, the amendment fails. Any other suggested amendments to the motion?
Well, I'd be happy with just limiting the hours of play in the cul-de-sac to 9 to 4 o'clock. Those hours, hopefully, prior to 9 o'clock, people have gone to work, gone wherever they have to, and then after 4 is when they most likely are being picked up. So you're off, or you're out of the cul-de-sac at that hour. So restricting or limiting the children to play in the cul-de-sac to 2 hours, 9 to 4 o'clock.
But she only operates them to 2.
Pardon?
Isn't the application say she only wants to operate until 2 o'clock?
Well, the proposal was 8:30 until 5.
One
I'm sorry.
One day it goes until 5.
Yeah.
I would like to have something that says adequately supervised or supervised if they use that, if they use the cul-de-sac.
You can amend my amendment if you would like.
Well, why don't we just vote on see if there's a second to the amendment. The amendment is that there's the operation of the business. You said play. Is it fair to say operation of the business or play?
I hope they're not going to operate in the cul-de-sac.
Well, that's
but
I
if
mean,
they play, it'll allow the children to play in the cul-de-sac.
Okay, they won't allow the children to play in the cul-de-sac between the hours of 9 to 4. Is there a second?
We'll allow.
Excuse me. They will allow children to play in the cul-de-sac limited to the hours of 9 to 4.
I'll second that amendment.
Okay.
And that satisfies my concern about lighting.
All in favor of that amendment? 4, all opposed, 1 opposed. The amendment passes. Are there any other proposed amendments to the motion?
No, I would propose that no child be allowed to play unsupervised in the cul-de-sac area.
Seconded.
All in favor of that motion? 3, all opposed. Okay, that no unsupervised play in cul-de-sac. Anything else by way of amendment to the motion? All right, hearing none, I guess we can open
the
move the question, which is to grant the, correct me if I've got anything wrong here, Alice, if you might help me, is to grant the conditional use permit, or allow the conditional use, with the conditions that the fence be of a type that a young child cannot easily go over, around, or through the fence. Number 2, that play in the cul-de-sac be limited to the hours of 9 to 4, and that during those hours, play must be supervised. That's.
We need to address the conclusions before we vote on that. We have been doing that just so that it shows on the record.
Right.
Mr. Cronin, do you want to give us the factual basis for your motion?
Whereas the proposed use of will not create hazardous traffic conditions when aid in existing foreseeable traffic in the vicinity, and whereas the proposed use will not create unsanitary conditions by reason of sewage disposal, emissions to the air, and other aspects of its design or operation, and whereas the proposed use will not adversely affect the value of adjacent properties, and whereas the proposed site plan and layout are compatible with the adjacent property uses and with the comprehensive plan, and whereas the design and external appearance of any proposed buildings will constitute an attractive and compatible addition to the neighborhood, where that provision is not relevant, be resolved that the board grants the approval of the conditional use for the operation of a home care center, subject to the conditions voted on already.
All in favor of the motion? All opposed? Hearing none, the motion is granted, and the conditional use with those attached conditions is granted.
I don't understand.
No.
Why has to go for interviews? The person says it's a pretty good.
I'd like to keep moving on the agenda because of the length of the first item and possible length of the other items that we have. So if the applicant for the next agenda item, which is to hear the appeal of Thomas A. and Mary L. Cleary, 426 Mitchell Road, for a frontline property variance of 22 feet 6 inches from the required 40 feet and a right side property line variance of 4 feet 6 inches from the required 20 feet. If you could come to the podium. Just give us 1 second to get our ship in order. Are you ready? Okay. If you could state your name and address. And
My name is Peter Palanza, and my address is 5 Short Road, Cape Elizabeth. And I'm representing the Clarys on the basis of being a contractor and draftsman for the project.
Can you speak closer to the mic, please?
Yes. I'm here to answer any questions that you have regarding the application.
Guys, we're sort of changing gears quickly here, so I'll give you a second, but if any of the board members have any questions, now would be the time to raise them.
How does the proposed...
Let me just make sure. You didn't want to present anything, or you want to just open it for questions?
Yeah, open for questions, pretty much. We got this presentation that explains quite a bit, we thought.
Yeah, I'll know for the record there's a somewhat bounded application that was submitted in addition to the normal application document. And Mr. Cronin?
Yeah. How does the footprint of the proposed structure relate to the footprint of the present structure?
The footprint of the proposed structure is, we'll be adding on, the existing structure is 24 by 36, so we'll be adding on a 10 by 24 addition downstairs next to the garage, and then to moving to the left of the house facing it towards next to the garage, and then going with a full upstairs, which would be 24 by 46. On the statement, it said 24 by 40 to the second floor, which is incorrect. The agenda, I mean. Mm-hmm. So it actually be 24 by 46 on the second floor, and a 10 by 24 addition on the bottom added to the 24 by 36. That's not too confusing.
I got that off the project description of the building. But
oh, you did? Okay. Maybe I...
But it doesn't affect the variances that was advertised.
Okay.
So that shouldn't be a problem.
Go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I read your proposal and what you're doing. I had a number of questions, and your reasoning as to why the land in question cannot yield a reasonable return unless the variance is granted. One of them was the garage is not attached and has no foundation. And
yes.
I'm wondering how that has a bearing on not yielding a reasonable return. The way I looked at it, it's, the garage is going to stay basically the where it is and the way
yes.
it is?
Is well, it'll be attached once we put the addition on, so they feel that if they can pretty much go from the house to the garage, it'd be a lot better than going outside in the weather. So if they pull in the garage with groceries or whatever, they can go from the garage right into the house, even though it's a small garage.
But I saw no entrance from the garage to the house on the plan. And that's why I was concerned or questioned that rationale. The other comment was that, let's see. The fact that the kitchen was small is a limiting factor to the saleability of this property. Was this property offered for sale and no one wanted to buy it because the kitchen was too small? Is that how?
No. No, that wasn't the case. But they speculated that if they do sell it, that that's going to be one factor that would hurt the sale. Would be the kitchen is very small.
But they haven't tried to sell the house, so they don't know that for sure.
No, it's only speculative.
Okay. What are the sizes of the two bedrooms now? Do you have any idea?
One's 12 by 14. The other one's approximately 10 by 14, right. The back one.
See, to me, those really aren't small bedrooms, especially when you're talking the size of the house. And I think one of the things you're going to have to do for me is to convince me that this house, if put on the market, could not yield a reasonable return. I looked at the values of the properties around, and I established a rough idea of what the house might bring based on what was presented to us, the visual of the property, and the houses in the neighborhood. And I also looked at your estimate to make the improvements to this house. And I'm wondering if you're going to over-improve the house for the neighborhood. And again, I'm looking on Mitchell Road. I'm not looking behind the property. So I'm not convinced that by spending $70,000 to expand this house is going to yield a reasonable return. I am more convinced that you would not receive a reasonable return. And maybe I'm talking to the wrong person. I should be talking to the owner of the property. But your justification why the land in question cannot yield a reasonable return has not convinced me that granting a variance would is justified, quite honestly. And the other thing is we're talking about expanding back, and you said the cost of the addition would be greater than the increased value of the house. Did you work out a proposal to expand the house backwards to give them what they wanted?
We worked out some numbers, and we figured be in order to get what they asked for on bedrooms and kitchen size, 30% more probably with the foundation and layout, plus pump trucks for foundation cost and excavation. Really can't get any machines back there. You probably know that, being a contractor, it'd be hard to. You know, it'd be a lot easier going up, a lot less expensive than it would be going out back. And to go out back, maybe you'd probably have to add on 40 feet, 24 by 40, to ask what they're asking for, you know. The extra bedrooms, bathrooms. And larger kitchen is one of the biggest hardships.
That's all I had for questions.
Any other questions, Amber?
What's the lower level used for?
The first floor?
Well, you show a first floor here, but there's obviously a walkout or a daylight basement or something down there. What's the...
It's basically unfinished walkout basement. That's a very, very small. I mean, the area that you walk out, maybe 14 feet of the 36 feet in the back. You can see it on it.
So there's no living spaces in the lower level then?
No, there isn't. No, it's unfinished completely.
Is it, could it be fixed up?
It'd be, for bedrooms, it'd be a problem with egress, code-wise.
Yeah, I was thinking, yeah.
Any other questions?
A curiosity question. How long have the owners owned the house?
6 years.
I'd like to respond to some of the questions that you've
asked. Why don't you step up then and let me just ask, are there any other questions for the contractor for you?
I'm still trying to figure out where the setbacks are from. Is this a front setback? Is it all side setbacks? I can't even find where this is specified.
It's a front setback and a right setback there we're asking for.
A setback to the north side of the house?
Facing,
if Mitchell Road runs north and south.
It would be facing west. The front would be facing the west.
The front faces west, okay.
Yes.
The right side from looking from the road.
The right side.
Right side facing
the south side.
Road, yes.
Is the front, excuse me, will the front of the house be any closer to the road after the addition than it is right now?
No, it will not.
Okay. So you need a front setback and a side setback. Is this right, Ruth?
The side setback.
That's correct.
Okay. I'm just trying to see where this is applied for in the application. I can't find it.
Last page, if you look on the last page of the application, second to last page, you'll see a plot plan. And the blue lines will show you the measurements.
Okay. So
one is 17.6, so in, on the front.
And Bruce, what is the law on this? Is it a 20-foot side setback? And a,
correct.
And a 25-foot front setback?
40-foot.
40-foot front setback. Okay. It should be 40, and there should be 25. All right.
Bruce, is the side going any closer to the side boundary than the current structure?
No, but it's an increase. Any increase to a non-conforming structure in square footage is not approvable through my office. A non-conforming structure can only exist in the square in the usable square footage and the footprint.
Right.
Any increase in that could not be authorized, even though you're not going closer to a property line.
So in both on the front on the, and on the side, they're really not moving any closer to the property line.
That's true. They're not becoming more non-conforming as right. far as distance goes.
I understand.
Okay.
Ms. Cleary, did you want to?
Yeah, I wanted to answer the questions that you had already asked.
Please speak into the microphone.
As far as the size of the current bedrooms, one is 10 by 13. That's the largest one. And the other one is 11 by 9. That's if you're like in the house measuring wall to wall. As far as the basement is concerned, it gets a lot of dampness. So it's really not an area that would be livable. And the only reason that we really need the variance is because the house was built before these existing codes were in effect. On the right side, we're not expanding the house over at all. We're just building up on the existing structure. As far as the footprint is concerned, we're adding 10 feet by 24 feet on the left side. That's the only change to the footprint of the house.
And that's within setback areas. That's not an issue.
The only part that's at issue is the front part, which would be a
okay.
continuation
okay.
of the existing front.
I guess I have to question the wisdom of
I mean, this house is awfully close to the road, I thought, by your house that I mentioned. And are you sure it's worth investing $70,000 to put that kind of structure at that house, which is 17 feet from the road, from a very busily, heavily traveled road?
It's 17 feet from the front property line.
Yeah.
It's like 34 feet from the road. I've measured it, the house, to the road. But when we had the Class C survey done, they established where the front property line is, and apparently it goes quite a ways up into our front yard. But in terms of, that does sound like a lot of money to invest, but it actually is less expensive for us to do this than it would be to purchase the size house that we would like, and that we're going to need, actually, in this town, and we really want to stay in this town.
Did you give consideration to demolishing this house or part of it and moving further back away from the road so you'd only need a side setback? I guess is the question I'm raising.
Demolishing it?
Yeah.
Well,
how much did you look into that to figure how much long more would be to build this size house without violating the front setback? Did you look into that? No.
I'm sorry, I didn't understand.
You're investing a lot of money into this property, which I think is very close to the road, from my perspective. And I'm asking, is there a reason, did you consider even demolishing this house and moving further back so you would come in conformity of setbacks and be much more aesthetically placed? You have a lot of area in the back there. You have 116 feet. So you would, technically speaking, you could build a house without violating the front setback. And I'm asking if you considered that.
No, we haven't considered that. I think
you have
that
something about ledge being back there. Or?
Well, one of the reasons that we like our lot is because of the way the backyard is set up. It gives us a lot of space back there. We have a 2-year-old daughter. We're planning more kids, and it gives us a lot of room for her to play back there. And it's, but in terms of demolishing the house and moving it back, we hadn't considered that. But I would guess that it would be quite costly to do that.
How many square feet is this new vehicle? Is this new house?
It would be 24 by 46.
And two floors?
Two floors, yeah.
2,000 square feet. What's construction cost now, Joe? $80 a square foot on average?
Depends on what goes in the house.
Yeah, on average.
Be conservative, go 60.
I have no further questions.
I have a question on the future use of the downstairs area. And my proposal, it's the gray lined area.
Oh, okay.
You've got a huge living room and a kitchen with stairs. And what, is it going to remain constant?
The rooms that are now bedrooms in the downstairs area, is that what you're referring to?
Well, I'm referring to the gray area on this.
The gray area is, that's existing. That's the existing bedrooms.
Okay, so you're gonna.
They're not gonna be, well, one of them is a den. The one in the back on the left. Yeah, that's a den.
That's a current den now. So you've got a den plus two bedrooms in this house.
Yes, yes. And that room's only 8x9. And the other, there's not going to be any bedrooms in the downstairs. The front room would be more just like a room with a couch and coffee table, a place where you could like read or, you know, do something quietly. The family room will just be enlarged, and the other room is going to be a playroom.
I
I'm still puzzled by the garage and the proposed use of it. It's only 12.6 by 20.
Yeah.
Not a large garage.
No.
I think the doors swing open. How do the doors on the garage? What are the
on
doors?
On our garage? No, it's just a regular garage.
Roll up?
Yeah.
It rolls up?
Normal garage.
There's still no proposed access from the interior of the garage to the house.
There was, we had originally put a door from the garage to the house. Uh-huh. But when we did that, it reduced the kitchen space. And because the garage, we cannot move the garage forward, we couldn't move the garage forward so that we could place a door from the house to the garage. So instead, we put a door on the back of the garage, and there's a door that goes out the kitchen, so you have to walk maybe 2 feet from the kitchen to the garage, out the back.
But there's no proposed alterations of the current garage.
There will be a small foundation under it. Right now, it's on. It's not on a foundation.
Do we have to grant a variance for that, Bruce?
To replace the existing garage, no.
The foundation under the garage, we don't have to grant a variance for that. Okay. One last question. Your proposed kitchen here shows it's 12 feet from exterior wall to the interior wall.
Well, let me find it. Oh, yeah, that's not a wall, it's a bar.
Okay, but it's 12 feet from the exterior wall to that bar.
Yes.
You back out 2 feet for your kitchen cabinets. Actually, this looks like it's a little wider than 2 feet, approximately 3 feet. That's 5 feet from 12, actually it's 11.6. Is there going to be a formal dining room or someplace where you have a dining table or a table where you sit at, or are you just going to use the bar for your meals?
The table is going to go, it's kind of going to be in the family room. It's not a divided room, but part of it will be an eating area.
In the living room?
So the front of the left.
In the living room?
Yeah.
Okay. I was just wondering where you're going to take your meals, because At 7 foot 6, it doesn't give you an awful lot of area to place a table in the middle of the room and be able to walk around it. Okay, Bruce. Okay. Did I come around? It was too far for you to follow me. That's all.
Anything else? Thank you. Is there anyone else who'd like to speak? We'll open up to the public. Is there anyone who'd like to speak on behalf of the applicant? Is anybody here opposed to this application? Okay, the public hearing is closed. I'll open it up for discussion to the board.
I not a great deal, but to address Joe's, I guess it was Joe, maybe Bob's concern on investing $70 in that neighborhood. I think that that's a personal decision that somebody has to make. And I guess I can understand making that determination. They like their neighborhood. It's kind of a nice-looking backyard. I'd like to stay there. Maybe others will do the same once they set a standard. So I don't particularly take that as a concern. Hardship is tough. I guess it's a hardship if you like your house and you like to enlarge it, make it seem better. So I consider it a hardship if they don't have a successful adventure here. So I can segue and wash myself right through that one.
Any other comments?
I think Amory should make a motion to approve.
I guess my concern is that part of the hardship is being this unwillingness to move back from all the houses in that area that I looked at were relatively small houses, so this one, going up, being a two-story house, would A, be out of scale with the rest of the neighborhood. I'm concerned with that. The hardship that results to the front setback is a self-imposed hardship by not willing to you could leave the existing roof here and build back within the front setback, the side setback. I'm sympathetic to. I have more problem with the front setback as a self-imposed hardship. And that's why I'm raising the question, well, is it really worth it to build that close to the road with that kind of money, which I keep coming back to the idea of self-imposed hardship, that they just don't want to build any further back. And
I think that's a subjective matter.
Yeah.
It's a matter of taste. I'm sympathetic to the application because I don't see any additional incursion on boundaries here. The front of the structure isn't moving any further forward than the current structure is, and the side of the structure isn't moving any further to the side. So there's no additional incursions on space that's not built on right now as far as getting closer to the boundary. So that by itself makes me sympathetic to the application.
Joe, did you want to
discuss it? I haven't got by letter A yet, why the land in question cannot yield a reasonable return. I feel as though the land in question can yield a reasonable return. And if you took the 100 plus that the house would bring and add the $70,000, I believe that you can find something in Cape Elizabeth for under $200,000 that will, I won't say duplicate the floor plan that was presented to us, but certainly give them the living space that this floor plan has afforded. So I can't get beyond letter A to get down to B and C and D. I believe the property can yield a reasonable return. And I hope you people have looked at that.
Define reasonable.
Well, reasonable return. You can sell the property for more than they paid for it 6 years ago. That's a reasonable return.
Even adjusting for inflation.
A property like this in Cape Elizabeth, affordable housing, actually affording someone probably a purchase price cheaper than rent, it could sell it tomorrow morning by 9 o'clock. And that's why I asked if the house was put on the market and if they were told that the small kitchen would reduce the saleability of it. And I think that the person who would buy this is either a single parent with one child or a single adult that would buy this simply because they want to be in Cape Elizabeth. I am not convinced that this house cannot yield a reasonable return. I really believe it can. And by adding the $70,000 to whatever they get, I think that they can find something off the beaten path, Bob, off a major thoroughfare. There might be a couple of houses from the previous neighborhood that might be coming on the market tomorrow. But I'm not convinced. I'm not convinced but I'm only one individual.
I don't know that we have any sort of record evidence that would support that beside speculation. We weren't ready in the last application to except speculation about property values. And I think all we have here is the testimony of the applicant and nothing in opposition to that to contradict what they have said is that the way the house is currently set up, they cannot get a reasonable return. And so that being the only evidence presented to us, I'm not ready to go on anything but what we have before us.
A reasonable return doesn't necessarily mean a monetary return. A reasonable return in their mind is living. A reasonable living situation is a return to them in a certain way. So I feel that number one, they're not really asking for much more than a horizontal, vertical variance. And a slight extension of the front house. So I'd like to make a motion.
Well, if there's no other discussion, we'll entertain a motion.
Okay. Let's see. I would approve the appeal of Thomas A. and Mary L. Clary of 426 Mitchell Road, tax map U30, lot 21, for a front property line variance of 22.6 inches from the required 40 feet and a right side property line variance of 4.6 inches from the required 20 feet to add 10 foot by 24 to the first floor and add a 24 foot by 40 foot second floor.
46 feet.
Oh, excuse me, 46 second floor to the existing dwelling. In the finding of facts, the Clearys are the owner of this property. The conclusions, the land in question cannot yield a reasonable return unless a variance is granted. The need for a variance is due to the unique circumstances of the property and not to the general conditions of the neighborhood. The granting of a variance would not alter the essential character of the locality, and the hardship is not the result of action taken by the applicant or a prior owner.
Is there a second?
I'll second it.
Any discussion?
Let me express my other concern was provision C, the granting of the variance will not alter the essential character of the neighborhood. Locality, the older houses I looked at, there are no colonials that are this close to the road. They're relatively small, you know, 50 subdivision houses along the road. I think that close to the road, we have to consider the dimensions of the structure. I'm trying to imagine it in my own mind and whether or not it impacts enough to change the essential character of the neighborhood, but that's another one of my concerns I don't want it to bring up.
I think the essential character of the neighborhood got changed when they put Cranbrook in. You look over their house and you see a rather large house right over their roof. Maybe they're trying to hide it.
Any other discussion?
I have a concern, still a concern with the garage. And I'm looking at the proposed colonial that was submitted to us. And that garage looks dwarfed next to the house, and I would hate to see them come back in another year or two and say they wanted an additional variance to raise the garage and basically build a new one. So I would like to add an amendment that the applicant would be restricted from coming back to ask for a variance to expand the garage.
Point of order, can we do that? What does that impose? Does that restrict future boards from there?
Yeah, I don't know that we have any authority. Bruce,
I doubt if that would be anything you could do.
Could we?
Anybody can ask for variance.
Right.
Could we allow the record to show that I did request this and that I was correct, or I was put in my place by the powers that be?
I think that's appropriate.
That's appropriate.
That it's in that the record that there was a concern.
It might be appropriate that the board decided on the rest of variance based on the fact that was going to be remain a one-story.
Of course, you could vote on it and vote me down, too, but I just have a serious concern that that garage is not appropriate for the size house.
Well, I have some concerns that I have to talk to the contractor about the roof coming into the side of the building anyways. But
well, I didn't make any comment about any alterations to the garage. Are they allowed to make alterations to the garage? Changing the roof line of any sort?
Sure.
Yeah. As long as they stay within that footprint, they can.
As long as they don't increase the footprint or the usable square footage.
And go above the roof line, the current roof line?
No, if they create usable square footage on a second floor, that wouldn't be allowed without coming back.
They could
to this
put
board.
A cricket. They could put a cricket in the garage to kind of blend into
sure.
the. Okay.
Any other discussion? All in favor of the motion? All opposed? 5-1. The motion is granted.
I always have to hold my nose to vote.
I suggest we have a break.
Yeah. The board is going to take a 5-minute recess before we address the last two agenda items.
Give you a chance to rest.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Oh boy. See if I can break it too.
Stop breathing.
sure it'd be great. We tried, in history, this was the associated with the first if you had no purpose,
you and I will slide it together.
Sure. I didn't get the
if I stayed on here for any length of time, I would want to require a hearing.
Well, I'll type those up.
I turn into a pumpkin. The hearing will reconvene at this time.
Are we on, Tom?
Somebody up back there just knock on the door and ask him to put us on.
Since I'm here,
these are.
Are you okay back there with the exhibits that are up on this stand? Is that easel affecting you at all? You need them moved? Could you move them more next?
Sorry about that.
We wouldn't want to block Joe.
You probably don't have to go back that far.
Is that okay? Is that? More so it faces that way. Doesn't matter that we can't see it.
That's all right. I don't need those.
If we have any questions, we can. We'll reconvene the hearing at this time. The next item on the agenda is to hear the request of St. Albans Episcopal Church for a conditional use permit to remove the present parish hall structure and relocate the same uses in a new addition to the existing church. Someone here on behalf of the church?
Mr. Chairman, just for the record's sake, I'm a member of St. Albans. And while I don't think anything that's going to happen tonight is going to be a problem, but I do present that to anybody to see if they want me to step down. Sort of the same position you two were in the last with St. Bart's. No problems?
I'll put that question to the public and the board members. If anybody has any objections to Mr. Houghton sitting on this hearing. Okay, I hear no objections from anyone, so
fine.
Go forward. Could you please identify yourself?
Yes, I'm Nancy Barbey, and I'm with Barbey Architecture and Preservation in Portland, and we're the architects for the project. With me here tonight is Cynthia Wheelock, who's my partner, Tony Minch, who's a landscape architect that's working with us, and Ward Taylor from the church. I'll go through some of the information I submitted. I know it's getting late, so I don't want to be redundant, but it's probably important to go over most of the points, unless you want me to skip to the meat.
All I would ask is that we're gonna take under consideration the request for the conditional use,
right?
And then we're gonna talk about the
daycare.
Separate permit for the daycare. So
right.
You just at this point confine your comments to the addition to the existing church, and understand that we have lots of stuff before us, and we've considered it. Everyone has.
Oh, good, good. The project that we're planning with St. Albans is to remove the present parish hall and construct a new attached parish hall to the present church. There'll be expansion of the on-site parking, extensive landscaping. The current parish hall was built about in the early 60s and is inadequate in several respects, including cramped Sunday school rooms. They're really substandard in size for even small groups. Space for church and community group meetings is insufficient. Handicap access is pretty much non-existent. And during inclement weather, a lot of people don't even make it to the parish hall for coffee hour afterwards because of the having to go out in the weather and get back in. So they're really hoping that by doing these improvements, they'll improve the function and shortcomings and the property, the appearance of the property. Just to go through some of the features of the property, there's actually four buildings on site presently. There is the parish hall, which is dotted in on the site plan, the rectory, existing rectory, which is where the priest lives or had lived in the past, the church building itself, and a garage for the rectory up in this corner. What we're proposing to do is to remove the parish hall, either by demolition or having someone move it off-site if it's desired to do so, and move the existing functions into the proposed addition. All of the functions would be identical to the ones that are being currently used, with the exception of the request for the daycare nursery, which comes under the second conditional, our second piece of our conversation tonight, or second approval. When we remove the parish hall, we're talking about removing it down below grade and loaming and seeding it. The rectory in the Episcopal Church is becoming more and more common not to have the priest live on site. It's becoming less of a tradition, and there are a lot of reasons. One is that they'd like to get into property ownership, and often the priest was always kept from that. So St. Albans at this point was advised to at least discuss the possibility of a future separation of this as a residence. So we've shown on our plans a possible division of property in the future. It's still in the very early discussions. There's probably as many parishioners that are against it as for it, and it's just in discussion purposes. But when you're considering this, our request, we want to make sure that's on the table, that you know that that's a future possibility. And to that end, for the rectory property, we've looked at maintaining the required 100-foot street frontage, making sure we conform with existing zoning ordinances, setbacks for 20 feet from the rectory to a proposed new property line, and looking at access to the site through the present parking lot or through the improved parking lot. So those items are considered in this, and also making sure that we have enough property so that we have more than 20,000 square feet of property to make it a conforming use. We're also improving the parking. Presently, the site is accessed from Shore Road, and actually this drawing would show you this better. This shows the access from Shore Road, and there's a drive that goes up that was originally the rectory driveway, and there's a large parking lot up in the back of the church. This orange outline is really the line of the existing paved area up in this area.
Swing that forward so you can be going by your mic.
So there's really two points of access to the site. One is off of Shore Road, and one is off of Oakhurst. And what we're talking about doing in the new plan is discontinuing this drive through the site, which has been useful and serviceable, but you'll see that it really bisects the site in a way that could be landscaped and be a lot more attractive in the neighborhood. And in doing that, we're also looking at expanding this parking area and creating a buffer that is not there presently. This is just an asphalt curb that adjoins Oakhurst. So we're looking at improving the siding and landscaping in that area and expanding parking that way and into this area, which has previously been unexpanded because there's pretty severe ledge outcroppings in this area. You can see these contours and you can see some of the ledge. We're hoping we're not going to run into problems there when we try to do that, but we're prepared to do some ledge removal to make this more feasible. Currently the lot is shaped in a, I guess it's a trapezoid shape, and there's no striping on the lines. It's asphalt. It sort of makes for a bedlam in parking. The church has been taking parking counts over the past couple of months to try to determine how many cars actually can fit on here. And we've determined that an average Sunday attendance at the 10 o'clock service, which is the most well attended, there's an average of about 21 cars in the lot and another 10 in the drive. So what the plan, the new plan proposes is 38 cars on site, including four in a small lot off of Shore Road. The bulk of them are up here with a couple of handicapped parking spaces that are directly adjacent to a new entrance and a drop-off that would be well-lit, and this small lot here, which was maintaining the existing curb cut off of Shore Road.
Is that increased capacity done by increasing the size of the parking lot or just by organizing it better?
Both. You'll see on this... on this plan, the size of the lot is here, and we're expanding it down and picking up six spaces along here, two of which are handicapped. And then we're picking up a driveway here, which allows us to pick up several spaces in here, probably six or seven. And we're picking up eight compact spaces here, which there's only about half of them, or there's about a quarter of that room there, maybe two real spaces. So. It's doing both. So again, with the exception of the limited capacity daycare that you'll hear about later, the uses in the present parish hall are proposed to move over into the new hall. And the church sanctuary can hold about 228 people, and there are about 12 choir members and four staff people on Sundays. And really, those pews are only filled on the top days, festival days, though I'm sure they'd like to see them fuller. There's about 150 parishioners, pledged families, and the 21 cars in the lot is what the standard average has been. If we were looking at a brand new church and you did the parking calculations, there would be required about 66 spaces, which would just, we think, would adversely affect the property values in the neighborhood and would just definitely impact the way the beauty of the site as it is today. And I'm sure we could try to accommodate them down in the location of the present parish hall and look at options for that. But we think from a design standpoint, from a aesthetic in the neighborhood, it's far preferable to provide the spaces that are necessary, as many as we can get on site, more than what's presently there for the same uses, and preserve some of this open space, which is hopefully compatible with the Cape Elizabeth Comprehensive Plan. So that's really the bulk of the application.
Thank you. Are there any questions of the board?
Yeah, I've got a question. Why do you need those four parking places down on Shore Road? I thought you were trying to get rid of that curb cut.
We're trying to get rid of the drive, and I actually think that the reason they're there is more to try to maximize the site use of parking. I don't think there'd be any hard feelings or any sense on the church's part. If those were gone, they'd probably be perfectly happy with that being just pedestrian access.
I think I'm seeing the property line. Is it cutting through the present parish house, which would be the new property?
Okay. That would be a new property line, right?
Why not put 10 or 12 cars up through there then? I mean, I think a 21 count is a low count, just from my own guess.
21 on site?
Yeah, it sounds very low to me. But you're, you figure you can put 38 up there?
It'll be 34 here and 4 here.
Oh, okay.
And the 21 is what is average. There was the maximum in that lot, I think they've found, is about 25. And then people park along the driveway, about 10 cars, squeeze in there.
Well, then why not put more, why didn't they use more parking space with the four, make the four 8 or 10?
Because, again, we think it would dramatically impact the landscape. It's really not, I think it's a really good thing that they're trying to get rid of this or open that up and make it more landscape like this plan, rather than putting some hard surface back in here right along the road and
I just,
paving.
You know, I just don't understand the four, but I guess that's not my business. What are you losing? It looks like you've got trees in the parking lot.
We're adding trees in the parking lot.
Are you losing spaces by putting trees in?
No. This one other feature that I didn't mention, if I can now, is this is the proposed play area for the daycare that would be fenced and hedged, and we can talk about that later, and also a terrace. So really trying to keep that from being a thoroughfare any longer, orienting this towards the green space.
Thank you.
I have another question about parking. Have you done counts of cars that are parked on either Oakhurst or Shore Drive during either services or evening meetings? Certainly, as a nearby neighbor, I've noticed many evening functions that have cars parked along Shore, and I wondered what impact or what kinds of concerns you've heard from neighbors about that. And
that's a good question.
How you factored that in and what your counts showed of cars.
Yeah. The church actually just started taking those counts after we had a meeting with the neighbors. I should mention that about 2 weeks ago, we invited all the neighbors that would be noticed publicly within 100 feet to attend a meeting and sort of hear about the plans. And I guess there's one neighbor here tonight. But at that meeting, I thought it was very positive, the feedback. And it seemed that it's the question of parking and traffic flow and such came up, and there was a lot of discussion about that. It seemed that maybe the neighbor can help address that, but it seemed like it was fairly positive review, and that there were some neighbors saying, well, it's once or twice a week that they get the street parking, and it seems like a very valid use of those spaces on the street. There was no real strong opposition to parking on the street. I think that you can count the number of spaces that you could fit on the street or that people can use. And if you look at the use in that area, I may be mistaken, but it seems like very few neighbors park out on the street. It's usually just used as drive, and there's a few curb cuts. That didn't seem to be a major concern, though. In some neighborhoods, it might be, and I would wager that it's because most people have driveways that are often not a whole lot. This is mostly St. Albans property edge. People that park along there are going there. So there's not a lot of competition for those spaces. Does that answer?
I think Joe.
Just your question.
I want to skip ahead to future uses. Do you have a drop-off and pickup area for people utilizing the parish hall?
Yes, it's the way the traffic pattern would work now, or as it works presently, people come and go from this access and come and go from an access right out here. And what we're proposing is to bring everyone in at this entrance, drop off here, and then back out.
You're going to have signs, entrance, exit?
They will have signs.
And this is going to be properly lit?
This will be properly lit. We have to go before the planning board.
Yes, I know
after
you do.
So
I know you do. You're
we'll
going
to have
fun
to
with
all
those people.
Yeah.
What about service areas? Do you have a service area for the beverage trucks for an event or something?
It's really the same
so
drop-off. I don't think that there are that many service vehicles that come and go in a church facility.
Never know.
As far as I know, there's no vending machine on site or I would think the, you know, maybe the flour delivery or for the pancake breakfasts probably be the big one.
Can't hear.
Yeah.
Okay.
One question back again on parking, because I'm surprised that it's been allowed, if you will, on Friday nights when Alcohol Anonymous meets. Shore Road is just, there's 100 yards of parked cars. Is this going to move them up onto Oakhurst? And is there going to be any apprehension from the folks that with them parking now on Oakhurst? Because I think that's going to be the main entrance.
It would become the main entrance, though. You can enter from this lower entrance to Offshore Road.
Yeah.
The plan will show you that there's an elevator right about here.
I can't see, so I don't know what you're...
Sorry. Actually, I should have the plan.
That's
all right. This is the lower level of the parish hall. There's a new lobby being created there, yeah. So there'll be a pedestrian access there. So people could park along the road still, come in here, go up an elevator, and end up at the parish hall.
But the, I guess my concern was that the residents who you met with did not express a concern about parking on Oakhurst.
Not to any great degree. I think they recognized that the AA met there on Friday nights, and that was a large impact, and we didn't have parking counts on that at the time, and they're working on those now. But I don't know. It wasn't a huge discussion, because it's sort of they come and they go.
Yeah. Thank you.
Are there any other questions? Thank you. Is there anybody else here to speak on behalf of the applicant? Any members of the public who wish to address this? Could you come to the microphone, please, and state your name so it's on the record?
My name is Christopher Kelly. We're a direct abutter. We're at 26 Oakhurst Road. And I'd like to follow up on some of the parking issues that came up, and I think they were accurately portrayed with regard to the people that attended the meeting held 2 or 3 weeks ago at St. Albans, where the plans and ideas were broached. And where there were probably 4 or 5 abutters present out of a total of 22 attended the meeting. And you can see here tonight there's only myself and Kay. Kay in the back, who's representing one of the abutters. But anyway, I just had some thoughts or concerns about overflow traffic if we take out... If this drive comes out, as is anticipated now, and the emphasis again is on the upper parking lot, which I understand it to be, whether or not that could somehow result in more cars parked along Oakhurst Road than are there today. I don't know what kind of parking occurs in here on Sunday, maybe 10 or 12 cars here in the driveway. And so then we have 21 in the lot now, and the lot's going to become 34. Okay, so we picked up these, and we've got them up here in the lot. So I guess maybe net, maybe that's all just the same. But that would be a concern. Like, for instance, in AA, it's never been a problem at our house. And just as clarification, our house is right here. It would be the first house on the left after St. Albans if you're going west on Oakhurst Road, and there's never any cars backed up in front of our house for AA, or very rarely for church. But you know, in the event that there is an emphasis on parking up here as opposed to on Shore Road or on this initial stretch of Oakhurst, then I think that there could be cars in the evening, Friday evening, pushing back up farther Oakhurst. And so I just would like to try to get comfortable with that possibility, or be sure that everybody's envisioning that as a possibility. Just because there's a nice new parking lot doesn't mean that how do we know it's going to work, I guess is what I'm saying. Maybe people will say, geez, this isn't working either, and we're going to park where we used to park, but these 10 or 12 spaces are no longer there, and it gets a little busier along the street. So there is one other.
Does anyone have any questions?
I was just going to comment. The reason for raising it is I do expect that the shortest distance from the street to the parish hall is going to be off Oakhurst with the new one. And the only thing I was asking, are people aware that it might just engender a new parking pattern?
Yeah.
Were they aware of it? That's all. I mean, I have no axe to
grind. I would agree. I would have the same question. Will it engender a new parking pattern? There's one other.
Any other questions?
I wanted to ask, too, if there's any way to clarify what the actual future plans are for the rectory now as we know them, because we talked about parking and there had been questions asked about the lower parking lot. Was it four cars? What's the use of the land down here? And my question is the lot being minimized down here so in the future the rectory can be sold without a parking lot associated with the church in the front yard? Does that have anything to do with the absence of a larger parking area down here where the old parish hall used to be? Are we keeping that largely clear so at some point in the future this property can be sold conceivably with a clear view down to the street and out to the water? And so perhaps that can't be answered now, but it's a thought that's crossed my mind.
I can answer that a little bit, but only to the extent that I know, which is
Ms. Barber, I'd like to give you a chance to address that, but I'm going to need you to come up to the microphone to do that. So as soon as Mr. Kelly's done, then.
Okay. I think that's it. Just observations.
Great. Thank you.
If you want, I may be able to address possible sale of the record a little bit.
Well, let me ask if there are any members of the public or anyone in favor of the application, want to speak on behalf of the application who hasn't spoken yet, would like to address any issues. I would include you if you want to speak. Or
I represent one sentence. I represent the owners of 897.
Ma'am, even if it's one sentence, I'm afraid you're going to have to come up here so we can get it on the record.
I'm Kay Sloan, and I represent the owners of 897 Shore Road. Two sisters own the property. One of them has seen this and is very pleased with it because with the removal of that building, and it looks like improved landscaping, it just makes it that much better for their property. So they think it's wonderful.
Okay. Any questions for Ms. Sloan? Great, thank you.
Yep.
Anyone else wish to speak on behalf of the applicant? If you'd like to address any of the issues that were raised, you may.
Actually, before addressing that, I want to, one other thing that came up with a meeting with the neighbors was something that Chris brought up, which was, could we narrow this entrance to give more area between a grass and buffer area between his property? And the answer is yes to that. This shows what we showed you that night. We can bring that out so that it's a narrower entranceway and still meet the standards. And you'll see that present line, we've brought more green area out from where it is presently, and this is more green. So just so they answer that question that wasn't even asked. As far as I know, the plans are not developed yet for the rectory, but our reasoning for the front lawn is to try to keep that 100-foot requirement of street frontage. And there's also a potential easement that St. Almond's will have to grant to any future property owner, which in some sense will restrict the use of it, I would think, or at least keep it in their control to some degree. But there's been no real discussion of what it could be. It really is would be up to a future owner. That's as far as the discussion's gone, I think, unless you know more, Ward. I don't know.
Are there any questions follow up to that point? Okay.
Thank you. If there's no one else who wishes to speak, we'll close the public hearing and open up to the board for discussion. Or a motion.
Bruce, could I ask you a question? Have you reviewed this with respect to the fact whether the rectory, the way the lot will be reworked, will the rectory and the land around it be an acceptable lot by current town standards? It won't require any variances to be sold.
It'll have the right square, the enough square footage and enough frontage to okay. be an acceptable conforming lot. Okay. Yes.
I'll make the motion. I don't know if that's what you're looking for at this hour. Make a motion that the conditional use permit to remove the present parish hall structure and relocate to the same uses in the new addition to the existing church be granted based on the finding of facts and conclusions outlined in the proposed list that we've been reviewing all evening. We don't have to read them all, do we? We're going to miss you, Emery. We're going to miss you.
Is there a second?
Second motion.
Any discussion? All in favor of the motion? All opposed? Seeing none, the motion carries. We'll move on to the next agenda item, which is to hear the request of St. Albans for conditional use permit for a daycare facility. And I would have the record reflect that we've heard the proposal on the prior conditional use and a lot of the layout has been explained to us and there's really no need to repeat things that might be overlapping facts. If there's anything additional that we need to know, you may do that, but at this point we have a lot of knowledge, so leave it to you to make it short and sweet.
Great. The application for daycare / preschool facility was being brought forward mostly at the suggestion of Bruce Smith and Maureen O'Mara because it's one of the future considerations that St. Albans is interested in pursuing and didn't want to not bring it forward at this point. It's still in the very early stages of development and hasn't really gone beyond a lot of discussion. Their thought is that they would model the program on the programs at Ledgemere and Maiden Cove, which many of you may be familiar with, and that they are going to have no more than 20 children on site during the week. The thought is that they'll have the facility all set up as a nursery school for during Sunday school use, and why not extend this need to the community because there's been so much demand for this kind of facility. Since the property is able to support that because parking is not an issue during the week, except on Friday nights, that this is a perfect compatible use with a shared parking component if parking's required for that. We will be providing a outside play area of minimum 75 square feet per child. I think we've shown 1,600 square feet. And it's going to be surrounded by a wire fence, which would be embedded in a hedge, which is our thought at this point. And that's all there is to it.
Chairman, can I ask a question?
Please do.
As I was looking through this, and I can't see your area, it doesn't appear that your fencing, does it go all the way around?
The fencing goes all the way around. Sometimes it's embedded in the wall.
Okay, that's why, I read that.
Other times it becomes a stone wall or retaining.
Okay. Is there a requirement, Bruce, that the fencing be attached to the building so that the yard is contained?
No, there isn't.
Okay.
The exit for the nursery is right here. It would be a short walk to this fencing area.
Okay, thank you.
Is
I've got another question. If this approval is granted tonight, how long do they have before the permission to operate elapses? Or does it go for, is it good forever? They have...
There would be no time limit once you get your approval. I mean, unless they stopped doing it for any length of time, but there's no spelled time limit.
In terms of starting up, I would suspect that it could be how long before they would consider starting a daycare? A year or two?
Well, it'd probably take a year before the building's constructed, and it may be another year before they get started, yeah.
So that is not going to impact upon the permit?
Good question.
I should have excused myself.
My experience, although it's limited, it was my understanding that it's 1 year if once they receive their approvals to either start operating, or if there is a lapse between the time they stop of 1 year or so that permit has been
If you fail to initiate the operation of conduct of the conditional use within 1 year of the day the board's vote to grant such approval, then it becomes null and void.
Bruce, you're going to have to repeat what you just said. It sounded relevant, but I couldn't hear it.
if the applicant fails to initiate the operation or conduct of the conditional use within 1 year of the date of the board's vote to grant said approval, then it expires.
Can they come back in 11 months and ask for a renewal of this because the building is not in proper order?
I don't know why not. Or you could, I'm not so sure that the board may be able to grant approval based on the actual occupancy of the building addition.
Wouldn't it be more appropriate to come back when they're ready? I mean, is half a dozen one, six of the other? I just don't understand.
The reason why we included the daycare or suggested we include the daycare is because they have to go through the planning board process and the Board of Appeals process for one, and we thought this would make it an awful lot easier instead of having to approach a board again in a year and expend more monies. That was the reason, the thought behind it. There again, nobody took into consideration the fact that it would be at least a year before they started the operation either. But I would think that it would be appropriate if you proved it tonight that if the year lapsed, that they could come back and say that there's been no changes, and the board could, based on that, could expend another 12 months for startup.
But they would have to come back if a year lapses.
To the extent to ask for an extension, yes. It sounds like that's what the audit says.
What is the section that you were referring to in
page
1 year?
Page 49.
Article 5. Conditions F.
Catch hell, but when I get home, if I suggest that they table this for a year and come back, I guess I don't really understand the significance of, they still have to go through another procedure before the board.
Can I raise a point of information? Is anything you're building now contingent upon getting approval for a daycare center?
The play area.
I'd like somebody to try and address it. It's a point in information.
I'm Ward Taylor, and I'm on the building committee. And the prime reason we included this now, because we thought from the understanding was that if we didn't include it now and at least ask for it, and we came back a year from now, somebody said, well, why didn't you ask us before? We didn't even think about this fact that we'd have to do it again in a year. So we may want to rethink it ourselves when we have another meeting, if we have to come back in a year. We just didn't want to come to you saying, we're going to build a church now, and then come back a year later and say, oh, by the way, we'd like to do a daycare, or like the same thing with the possibility of selling the rectory is a real bone of contention in the church. And it's not something we're really planning on, but we don't want to have not set it up so that we can do it should that become a future possibility. And we thought the same thing applied there. We didn't realize it was a one-year thing. We'd have to do it over again. We don't currently have a plan to really jump in tomorrow and say we're going to go do a daycare. We've been asked on a number of occasions, would we consider putting a daycare in? And the current condition of the church doesn't allow us to do that because of the requirements for safety and handicapped access and a few other problems like that.
Can I ask you, as a further point, has there been any discussion about what the hours of operation would be or exactly how many children there would be?
We set it up based on 20 because that's about the number of people that would fit into the nursery room that would be used for it. So we set aside that amount of area, assuming we had to do this. And we don't have any current plans where we're talking about going out looking at doing it in the next year or the next 2 years. You know,
Is anybody else have any questions as long as we have him?
If the board chose not to act on your request for approval of a daycare right now, would that influence your plans in any way? And do you require that approval economically or in any other way
no.
to go forward?
That's not included in the economics of the building
okay.
right at this point.
It just seems to me that it's would be sort of a meaningless approval for us to grant right now since it likely would expire well before your building would be ready.
Yeah, because you know, at this point, by the time we go through fundraising and plus make sure we can afford it and do it, the thing probably won't be built for more than a year, so that it would be silly to start putting daycare in before the building's there.
Right.
Thank you. Does anybody else would like to comment? Do you have something further to add?
I'd like to ask a question. It would help us in our planning stages to know if there are any concerns about the daycare and the planning of it at this stage, because we need to at least plan for the area for it and look at the topography and the landscaping around it. It would help us, even if it was off the record. I would think that approval of occupying it, of being able to use it when the building gets occupied, is a good idea as a secondary thing. If you're comfortable voting on it, but if it can be renewed every year, because it may take a couple of years, it is conceivable that the church could muster up enough enthusiasm through fundraising that they want to do it right then. But so, I guess it's 6 1/2 dozen. But it would help us to know if you have any concerns at this point about the planning of it.
Amor?
They aren't jeopardizing themselves if they should opt to withdraw this. By withdrawing, they could come back in 6 months if they wanted to.
I think that's right.
There's no black mark on St. Albans.
That's right. As opposed to if it's voted down, if it's denied, then I believe there's 12 months they have to wait before coming back. Is that right?
I don't think there's a time frame for conditioning.
No, there's not.
There is for variances.
Does it apply to the conditional use?
Was this advertised as part of our discussions for tonight with the public and abutters?
Yes.
Take care. Okay.
Is there any other questions for?
No.
Would anybody else wish to
make any statements, either for or against or about this application?
I'll take the about.
Chris Kelly, we would just have questions to the effect of how many children? Is it 20? And if we're going to vote on it tonight, I don't know where you are on that, but do we have a ceiling at 20? And is that 20 at any time during the day, like 20 in the morning and 20 in the afternoon, so it's really 40? Or is it 20? And who's going to operate the daycare center? Is it going to be a St. Albans vehicle? Are you going to sublease the space? That kind of a thing. I just think that speaks a little bit to the operations, which the board may have alluded to loosely in the last couple of minutes or so, you know. So those are some high-level thoughts that I'd have if you're going to go forward with something this evening and vote on the making a decision with regard to the permit or what have you. You know, whether or not we need to consider or lay out for the record how many children, hours of operation, you know, who can operate it, whether it's actually affiliated with the church or whether it's a leased vehicle, that kind of a thing.
Is there any questions for Mr. Kelly? Thank you. If no one else has any other comments, I'll close the public hearing. And put it out to the board for discussion.
Tom, I've got a concern that we're going to give approvals to something we don't know. But possibly we might approve the concept of what they're doing, but prior to issuing a license, we might ask them to come back to fill in the blanks.
I would even suggest that we not make any approvals. The architect did suggest, or it was suggested, that they might withdraw their application until they're ready with more details, and that might be the guidance that we would give.
That would make my direction. I don't think an application should be turned in with a question mark on it, proposed hours of operation they don't know.
Yeah.
I mean, this is just alluding to what Joe has said. They're not really sure. And I don't think there's anything that's going to be lost by delaying the application. And they'll be more sure of what they're talking about.
Particularly in light of the demands we've made earlier tonight and last month, and when people seek to operate a home business, you got to be able to answer the questions. And it's not, I don't think it's their fault that they can. It's just a concept right now, and it's not a concrete plan. And that's just a consequence of asking for it now, not a consequence of any failure in the application.
Sounds as though you're asking for someone to table this then.
Yeah, I would suggest the chair.
You know, I would put a tabling motion on, but that's not going to be appropriate. It ought to be a withdrawal, I would think, because tabling does it not mean that it comes up, or do we just let it go into limbo?
As a point of order, a table motion has to be brought up to put back on the table, and until somebody proposes that, it's in limbo. It doesn't come up automatically.
I think that'll cause more problems than it would solve.
Chairman, I'd like to request that you suggest to the applicant they withdraw the application.
Provide that opportunity to the applicant based on what you've heard.
You can also ask to have a table.
You can ask to have it.
He can have it until he feels as though it's time to bring it back.
Yeah. I'm not sure I understand the objection to tabling it.
Well, my understanding of the table, if it's tabled, is that it would require a motion to get it off the table.
Yeah. It requires a motion to put it back on the table for discussion.
Correct.
To get it off the table for discussion.
And wouldn't that have to come from the board as opposed to the applicant?
Yes, sir.
I think if you withdraw it, then you leave it in their hands on what to do in the future as opposed to leaving it with the board.
Because the board would then have to bring it.
This could be 2 years from now.
Yeah, they would have to apprise the board that they want to bring it back on the table again, which means they would come to the board, possibly would take a couple of sessions to do that. Wouldn't you have to re-advertise it after that period of time?
That's right.
I, I mean, it just seems cleaner if they withdraw.
Yeah.
And there would be no prejudice to St. Albans.
Right.
I'm not sure that you would have to re-advertise if it's tabled, that this is the announcement that it's tabled. I'm not sure that any legal requirements to re-advertise. I may be wrong, but...
Right. Do we have to resubmit then, and then it has to go back out?
Yes. Yes.
And do we have more fees to go with it and all that stuff? So it's a matter of...
Yes.
Yes.
$75 fee again if you withdraw.
Is there any impact with the planning board on this approval? Do we need to bring the...
You can bring it forth to the planning board if it isn't approved here. It doesn't go anywhere.
But we could show them the play area that's...
You could show them a proposed play area, yes.
It seemed to me that we might want to entertain a table action so that we can take the concerns back to the building committee, discuss them, and either ask for on the agenda next month with detail or ask them to go on.
Okay. Sounds reasonable.
Yeah.
Thoughts slipped through my mind.
Am I correct in saying that motions to tables are not debatable?
Can't you?
That's correct.
Approve a daycare center without having to come to the board.
Okay. This is the applicant's request to table it. Is that what I'm hearing?
They're
saying that it is their request to table it. The applicant's request.
I'll move to table the. Proposed conditional use application to operate a daycare center by St. Albans.
Clarification, don't you have to table it to a time definite?
No.
Or to say indefinitely?
No. And Robert's rules of order, as a point of order, I believe it's tabled until it's moved off the table.
The applicant has requested a table and until such time as they request otherwise. So...
It could be to the next regularly scheduled meeting.
Is that what you'd like to have?
Well, right now there's a motion to table. Is there a second?
I'll second that motion.
Okay.
I would suggest an amendment to table it until the next meeting.
You can move it off the table the next meeting.
I will not have a vote after tonight on this thing. So I will just speak my final piece on it. I am concerned that if this goes...
Amory, there's no discussion on a motion to table, so I'm going to have to get you off on that.
Discussion. Okay, fine.
There's a motion. It's been seconded. Is there a motion to amend?
I made a motion to amend.
Okay.
Didn't hear a second.
Is there a second to that?
Second.
Motion to amend? Okay. Motion to amend was to
table it until the next scheduled meeting of the zoning board.
Okay. All in favor of that motion? None opposed. The application will be tabled to the next scheduled meeting of the zoning board, which is the fourth Tuesday of next month. Next item on the agenda are communications, none of which I'm aware of. There's no other items on the agenda, but I think that on behalf of the whole zoning board, I'd like to recognize Amory Houghton's contributions to the board over the last 3 years or so and wish him luck in future endeavors and say that we'll miss his wise counsel and motions.
Not to mention his editorial correction.
Otherwise, no other business. The meeting will be adjourned.
No, first one is Thursday. That's an open meeting.